It's time for TWiT this week in tech. What a great panel we have for you. Georgia Dow is here, Om Malik, and a brand new member of our TWiT panels, Mr. Greg Farrow from PacketPushers.net. We're going to talk about the latest with the decryption bill. Steve Gibson will stop by and explain what that's all about. Killing Revolve, was it a good idea or a bad idea? The Melatonin Blues and Facebook Live. It's all ahead next on TWiT.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT, This Week in Tech, episode 557, recorded Sunday, April 10th, 2016. A train wreck of Brobdingnagian proportions. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Carbonite. Keep your business safe this year. Protect files on your computer or server with automatic cloud backup from Carbonite. Try it free without a credit card at Carbonite.com today. And use the offer code TWIT to get 2 free bonus months if you decide to buy. And by Stamps.com. Here's an easy way for you to save time for your business. Avoid trips to the post office and use Stamps.com to get postage right from your desk. For our special offer, go to Stamps.com, click on the microphone, and enter TWIT. And by GoToMeeting. Be a meeting MVP. GoToMeeting is the online meeting tool that lets you easily collaborate and present from anywhere with one click, so you always put on your best performance. Step up your meeting game and start your free 30-day trial today at GoToMeeting.com. And by Casper, an online retailer of premium mattresses for a fraction of the price, because everyone deserves a great night's sleep. Get $50 off any mattress purchase by visiting casper.com/twit and entering the promo code TWIT. It's time for TWIT This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the week's tech news. And we have a great panel to get things underway here. Om Malik is joining us, the founder of GigaOm. He's at om.co and venture capitalist these days. You hid your bobblehead. Now he's just peering out at us. Even more creepily. How come? Is that a New York Yankees?
That's right.
Why do you have a Yankees bobblehead?
Because I like the Yankees.
Oh, all right.
See?
That's
number
nice.
Three.
Did they award you that on the field?
I wish.
On opening day?
From a friend.
That's nice. I like how he's just peering out around the corner. Also with us from iMore.com, Georgia Dow. She's a senior editor there and the host of the Vector Cast. Hi, Georgia.
Hello.
Great to see
you. Thank
you
for having me back.
Always a pleasure. Nice to see you again. And we have a newbie in our midst. Greg Farrow joins us. He is the host of Packet Pushers at PacketPushers.net, and you'll find him on the Twitter at Ethereal Mind. Hey, Greg.
How are you doing, Leo?
Joining
Thanks
us,
very much for having me on the show.
Joining us from Midlothian. No, where?
Cheltenham in the UK.
Cheltenham. Cheltenham. Mm-hmm. Very nice to have all of you here. Also joining us just for the a little bit at the beginning, Steve Gibson, our security guy. Steve has been following closely, kind of waiting for the other shoe to drop on this encryption thing. Of course, as we all know, The Department of Justice dropped their suit against Apple, saying, never mind, we got it. We figured it out. No problem. They've also admitted that they only can do it with older iPhones, that they cannot decrypt newer iPhones. And, Steve, just to kind of get people up to date, you were at one point working on your own crypto program, weren't you?
Right. I had laid out all of the architecture for a VPN called CryptoLink, which was going to make it super simple for basically solve a lot of the annoyances and problems that people have, for example, configuring and setting up OpenVPN, and then also using it in the real world by simultaneously sending packets out to attempt to open multiple ports to find a way out of a local network over to the VPN server and a bunch of stuff. But thanks to the Security Now podcast every week, you know, and our continual looking at what was going on, a few years ago, I was sort of reading the tea leaves And I decided to suspend that whole project because it became clear to me that the whole question of whether we were going to ultimately be allowed to have truly unbreakable encrypted communications was still not a settled issue.
And of course, shortly after you decided not to do CryptoLocker, Ladar Levinson of LavaBit abruptly went out of business. We found out later because the FBI had insisted that he hand over the keys to all of his customers' encrypted email in an attempt to find Edward Snowden at the time. And so we've seen this happen before. And on the show on Wednesday, on Security Now on Wednesday, or Tuesday, I should say, Steve and I were talking about Senate action. It's been widely considered at some point that the Congress would weigh in on this in an attempt in some way to give law enforcement access to encrypted data. Well, we've been waiting for Richard Burr, who's chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee. He's a Republican from North Carolina, to release the text of a bill that they're calling Feinstein-Burr. And we got what is apparently a draft of that on Thursday. Have you looked at the Feinstein-Burr?
I have. And we should also remember that this is what Tim Cook wanted, too. His objection was that this is too important an issue to just have some judge write a court order out of the blue and attempt to compel Apple to create code in order to give the FBI a wedge into a phone that they had. Tim wanted, said, look, this needs to be resolved one way or the other. We don't want to break the law, but, we also don't want to just capitulate to something that we feel is wrong. So ultimately, I think it's clear to all of us that it's not clear how far up it's going to go, that legislation of some kind to resolve what are the legal obligations of someone providing encryption, what the limits are. There is a bill in the California State Assembly moving along. And then, of course, up at the national level, we've got, as you said, this Feinstein-Burr bill. And it is as bad, as sweeping as it could possibly be. It mm-hmm. doesn't. And it's what I've been talking about on the Security Now podcast for weeks, sort of expecting something that unfortunately looks like this. It doesn't outlaw encryption, but it provides a law to compel decryption.
So the name of the bill, and by the way, we should mention this is a draft text released for comment. So we're commenting. I don't think Richard Burr wants our comments.
The president would have to sign it into law.
He's kind of indicated that he's somewhat on the side of, I think everybody in law enforcement and many in government are concerned about this going dark problem, this problem of criminals being able to use strong encryption to essentially go dark, to go, off the net, but still communicate. The name of this bill might tell you something. It's the Compliance with Court Orders Act of 2016. It's not very long, which is good. It's easy to read. It's 9 pages. Again, this is not in committee. This is just a draft that Burr is circulating so people will comment on it. But boy, oh boy, here's a comment from Kevin Bankston. He's the director of New America Foundation's Open Technology Institute. He says, I got to say, in my nearly 20 years of work in tech policy, this is easily the most ludicrous, dangerous, and technically illiterate proposal I've ever seen. What is the proposal, Steve?
Well, so it essentially says that anyone who encrypts communications, and they define that very broadly to be both in flight and encrypted storage, must provide a means to provide intelligible, is the word they use throughout, an intelligible, i.e. decrypted version of whatever it is that the court orders. And they use the term covered entity and then define it to mean, and I'm reading from the bill, the term covered entity, that is to say, who this applies to, means a device manufacturer, a software manufacturer, an electronic communication service, a remote computing service, a provider of wire or electronic communication service, a provider of a remote computing service, or, get this, any person who provides a product or method to facilitate a communication or the processing of storage of data. So it's essentially everything and everyone.
Yeah, the professor of law at George Washington Law School, Orrin Kerr, said that this would apply to Apple's App Store and Google's Play Store and the Windows App Store. So anybody who's providing software would be required upon court order to give this, to give up all of the information unencrypted.
Or somebody posting something on GitHub. I mean, this is,
yeah,
it's that broad.
GitHub,
it's not just,
yeah, you're right.
It's not just commercial entities. It's any person who provides a product or method to facilitate a communication or the processing or storage of data.
Now, by the way, Matthew Green, our favorite crypto guy from Johns Hopkins, says the White House declined to endorse Feinstein-Burr. But he said they took a complex issue and arrived at the most naive possible solution. What would this would mean, essentially, that anybody doing business in the United States would have to have a backdoor. It doesn't say backdoor. In fact, they've, Burr said this is just a performance proposal. This is, it doesn't say you have to, how you have to do it. It just says that you have to have a way to do it.
That, exactly. And that's what we expected. And I caution everyone to be careful about terminology, because terminology matters. And so no one mentions backdoor, and a backdoor brings with it a negative connotation. So all it says is that, for example, Apple would have to build in to their technology a means to allow, if they receive an order from a government. Now, that's the other really scary thing here is this says a government, and then but they're not talking about, you know, non-U.S. governments. They're talking about all government entities within the U.S., states and counties, and so it's not just law enforcement at the federal level or some Supreme Court order. It's some government official down the street can apparently compel this sort of decryption.
The EFF says, despite being in a golden age of surveillance, I mean, that's the other side of this, is that right now, it's only going to get better thanks to the Internet of Things. They can surveil us in all sorts of new and unusual ways. Despite being in a golden age of surveillance, the senators are pushing Congress to destroy fundamental aspects of computer security. This doesn't just open a door for law enforcement to keep up on criminals. It opens a door for criminals to invade us. And they go on to say, forcing companies to undermine their products will stifle the very innovation that built the American tech industry. And I don't, you know, I can't imagine that this would become law or even end up. But it's so important that we not sit back and say, oh, that couldn't happen. Go to the EFF. They have an action page. It will give you the name, address of your Congress critter if you're in the United States. And you can write to them. I strongly suggest you either phone them or write to them using snail mail so they can verify you're a constituent and register your feelings about this. I'm not going to tell you how to feel, although I think you could tell how Steve and I feel about it. But register your feelings about this, because this is something that's going to come to a head pretty quickly, I think.
It says here, the term government, as defined in this document, meaning that the government can compel,
right,
means the government of the United States and the government of the District of Columbia or any Commonwealth territory or possession of the United States of an Indian tribe or of any state or political subdivision thereof.
So the city council
Petaluma could ask for this. Meaning the mayor down the street.
Yeah. Wow. All right, Steve. I knew that you had he says he had a Google alert set that anything happened with Feinstein-Burr, he would
been going crazy, too.
I bet it's going crazy. But remember, this is a good time for you to weigh in, because this draft proposal is designed to get conversation. And now's the time for you to let your Congress critter know how you feel. Boy, that's just...
We'll talk some more on Tuesday.
Thank you, Steve. Steve Gibson, the host of Security Now. Every Tuesday, 1:30 Pacific, 4:30 Eastern, 20:30 UTC. Greg Farrow, the UK had the Snoopers Charter, right?
Yeah.
Similar?
Yeah. It's very similar in the sense that the Snoopers Charter in the UK is based... We don't have a Bill of Rights here. So as a citizen or as a part of society here, you don't get the rights that you get in the US through your Bill of Rights or in your Constitution. So we don't actually have some of the privileges that you have. And the Snoopers Charter was basically just reinforcing the existing law that you have no rights and the government has the right to take whatever it likes.
Great. And is that, is that the law? It's the Draft Communications Data Bill. It was proposed.
Well, the Snoopers Charter has had a substantial amount of resistance in the community. Yeah. People have been pushing back very, very hard, and to the point where the government's had to shelve it for now. There are other political things that have taken it off the agenda, but I expect it to come back in a year or two. The British government, one of the things that I don't think people are talking about in this debate is the reason why the government wants to be able to decrypt, and it comes down to money. The ability to use... to have a backdoor or to have unencrypted data is the cheapest possible way of implementing government. And as our governments keep making commitments to people to spend less and less on tax, you know, to take less and less tax and spend less on have small government, they need cheaper and cheaper forms of law enforcement.
This is a response to budget crunches. Automated
snooping. Follow the money. If you follow the money, you'll always get to the truth in the end of the day. Wow. So the cheapest way that they can collect data, of course, is to get access to unencrypted data sources. And this, the FBI, of course, needs to do more with less. And so the cheapest way that it could do it is to have these cases. Now, of course, they will always win if the encryption gets really, really tough. They can go back to the government and ask for more money. So I just see it as cheap money.
Yeah.
One other thing about this bill,
sure.
I may.
Yes, Greg.
Is it also... perhaps the most egregious part about this is the part where it says people must not obfuscate or encrypt the metadata. So that is, people must not only render up the data, but they must render up all the metadata around it.
Well, I think that's what the EFF meant, that we're in a golden age of surveillance, because that metadata not only is widely available, it can be at least in the United States, you can get it without a warrant. So it's, every carrier in the United States has a portal for law enforcement that they can log into, and for a small fee, a few dollars, get location information, information about who you call. They can't get the content, but they can get everything else, all the so-called metadata. And in many cases, that's sufficient.
I think the secret here is that during the Second World War, when Bletchley Park cracked the Enigma code, I'm sure everybody's heard about the Enigma code and so forth, but while Alan Turing was the guy who cracked the Enigma code, what a lot of people don't know is there's a guy called Gordon Welchman who actually had spent 5 years ahead of that collecting metadata. That is, they had actually been analyzing the Morse code that people had been using, and they were able to identify which operator was talking. So each of the operators had a signature.
By their hand. Wow.
By their hand on the Morse code. Exactly. And this Gordon Welchman was actually able to build a massive library of metadata around who and when, so that when they finally cracked the code with the Enigma machine, they were able to say, oh, that operator is sending that data, then to reference what they knew about the operator and where they were to say, yes, this is valid, viable cracked data. So the metadata is at least as, or perhaps more important than actually the unencrypted data. And this bill, when you read it, says it is illegal to obfuscate the metadata. That is, illegal to hide IP addresses,
right.
Illegal to hide you as the user, that, things like that. That worries me much more, even than the fact that there's no limits on what the court can ask for. Imagine a court going to Amazon and saying, give me all of your data.
Right.
Not just one person. I want
everything.
Anybody in the whole data center. I want to see it all.
Right. What is this? I mean, as an investor, this must cause some concern, because this certainly would impact business in the United States.
So I haven't really had enough time to look through the exact documentation, but from what I've read on the web, more than how I have thought about it, this is still early days. There's a lot more debate which needs to go on. And I think, we need to be very careful when in terms of making decisions around encryption and decryption from a business standpoint as well as security standpoint. I think everything is happening in the dark, and I think that is a bigger challenge right now for the whole community, especially in the investor community, is that no one really knows what is happening and why the decisions are being made. So I think, you know, we still need a little more healthy debate around this whole topic. And you'll see more and more conversation around it.
Yeah, my concern, if you're Apple Computer, you don't, and a law like this were to pass, you would have no choice except, I mean, if you either would give in, which I think they'd have to, or you'd have to leave the country. And right. I don't think that's an option. And by the way, where would you go?
Indeed. And I think the biggest challenge we have right now is that most people look at technology as a geographic, you know, like companies as geographic entities or services as geolocal entities. And that's not really the case because we live in a world which is, you know, kind of borderless. So,
right.
You know, Apple is not just a U.S. company. It is not just, you know, a Chinese company. It's all over the world. And so each decision has a bigger implication. I think that part of the decision-making process isn't really there. Nobody actually, you know, thinks about the larger global implications just yet.
Go ahead, Jordan.
I think you're absolutely right. I think that the problem is that many people, encryption is a really scary word, and I don't think that a lot of people understand, probably most of the people that listen to the show understand why it's so important. But I think that for many people, technology is really scary. And even the people that are writing these bills, after you read them, you can say it's almost like kids like writing like a wish list to Santa.
Yeah.
They don't know how they're doing it. They're just like hoping for it. And it's like if you've ever seen any horror film, they're like, you know what, I'm just going to open the door to this box, even though I don't know what's going to happen. And we're opening Pandora's box a little bit so the good guys can get in. But that means that everybody can get in. And I think that we need to have these discussions to help people understand what is encryption, why is it so important, because the government has been using very insightful, emotional arguments saying we have to catch the bad guys. But this actually also lets the bad guys catch us.
Yeah, I think that's the point I think Tim Cook tried to make. In some ways, this is, I think the release of this draft document is not, Burr knows better than to think that this can become law. It's just too, right now, the Senate, it's too contentious. And there's no certainty that the president would sign it, this president or the next president. So I think really
what's... But don't you think that's why it's so insightful is that they ask for like $100,000. I'm like, Leo, I want a loan for $100,000. And you're like, Georgia, there's no way I'm giving you $100,000.
That's crazy.
I don't even know you.
Right.
And then I come back with one. I'm just, okay, just $1,000.
Right.
And you're like, well, okay, in comparison, this seems pretty fair. And then that gets signed into law.
I also think it's more than just saying, oh, then we'll settle for less. It's more than a negotiation point. I think it's a message. I think this is a message to U.S. companies, but, you know, to your point, saying stop fighting us so hard because we could squeeze a lot harder. Mm-hmm. And a company like Apple, I mean, look at Steve's rational economic decision. Well, I'm not going to do a crypto product because I don't want to be put in that position. A company like Apple that's already in that position is probably going to be more likely to cooperate in the hopes that something more draconian doesn't become law. So my suspicion is that this isn't something that Feinstein, Burr, or anybody else thinks would become law. But as you say, it's a stick. And they're suggesting that, you know, maybe you guys want to be a little bit more helpful. The problem is there's no halfway with encryption.
No.
It either works and is impenetrable or it doesn't work. And it's penetrable not only to law enforcement, but as you say, to criminals. Go ahead.
I think there's some politics here too. The right wing of the American, the Tea Party and the extreme right wing would like to put this type of thing up and then watch the left wing
go crazy.
and you've go
been,
crazy.
You've been watching our election. you're kind of getting some insight into how it works here, are you?
Oh, well, it's the same sort of thing happens everywhere.
I'm sure,
right?
It is. Yeah.
I think there's many nuances. I think it's put out a bill like this, start the discussion, make it extreme if you wind it back. It's also political. The people who are releasing this are extreme right wing.
Well, now we should point out that Dianne Feinstein is a Democratic senator from California who has not been, she's moved farther to the right each year of her term, but nevertheless is ostensibly a Democrat.
I mean, I read this and it's a horror story, especially for American cloud companies. So people in tech who are followers of AWS or Rackspace or Google Compute or even Facebook. This is very bad news, because if this does get up, you're going to see a reaction from the European governments where they're going to legislate much harder than they're already doing to say people in Europe cannot do business with those companies. You'll have to take your data out. It's already a seesaw type of a thing there now. And if they push much harder, I think you're going to find a serious reaction and, you know, billions of dollars of revenue will be lost. And I'm not sure that they're caring about that.
Yeah. I think really what has to happen at this point is that we as users now need to educate ourselves about crypto. I know you're right, Georgia, that a normal person. See, what Apple's doing and the thing that law enforcement doesn't like is they're trying to make it easy and universal. Mm-hmm. That's, I think, in the long run, probably not going to happen because of stuff like this. But it's very clear that if you know what you're doing, you can achieve strong, you know, privacy and strong encryption. And I think it would behoove all of us at this point not only to educate ourselves about it, about PGP, GNU Privacy Guard, WhatsApp, Signal, open whisper systems, strong encryption that is not penetrable to law enforcement and cannot be made penetrable to law enforcement, and then tell friends and family, you know, you can use WhatsApp now and be relatively secure, although metadata does leak from WhatsApp. You can be secure with WhatsApp, but as far as I can tell, and Steve, I'm sure, is going to weigh in on this a little bit more. He's reading the white paper. But it looks to, you know, WhatsApp uses your phone number to identify you, which makes sense. I mean, that's how your friends know you and can add you to their WhatsApp. But it's then attached to your identity on WhatsApp. And so there's some metadata leaking. Also, who you're talking to is leaked. So while the content is invisible, WhatsApp is not a perfect solution either.
You would think after the Panama Papers... that the government would be a little bit more like, wait a second.
Don't misunderstand that. They want strong encryption and privacy for themselves.
Right.
They're not saying that they don't get it. They're saying we don't get it. No, that's very important. Right. And I think that was part of the problem people had with David Cameron's stance on encryption. Greg, correct me if I'm wrong, is that, oh, no, we in the government will have strong encryption. It's just you that can't.
This state level, there's a big difference between state level actors and personal actors.
Right.
That is, when you're a state level infrastructure and you're like GCHQ or the NSA in the US or the DSD in Australia, the ability to collect data at such vast quantities, because you've got so much money and the legal empowerment to tap mainstream activities, that is the key. Now, when you're acting at that scale, having a back door or the, you know, the ability to unlock everything gives you unlimited capability to extract data. And I've heard various stories. Like, I work in enterprise security. My day job is about enterprise networking. And I can heard various stories about governments just capturing all the packets and then sinking them into bunkers so that they can play them back decades after they've been caught.
Right.
And that's where it is. And this is, these types of bills are all intended to keep the government in control over that data and over unlocking it so that they can extract it later on. I think there's the real weakness here, of course, is, and I don't want to turn this into a political show, but, you know, if the government start to act irregularly, like we've seen many abuses from the smaller police departments in the US, the English legal system's a little bit more unified than it is in the US and has different sorts of controls. But, you know, I think the big point is that this bill says any court member. So you could imagine a county court in some small town of rural America.
Something like maybe Maricopa County, Arizona. Mm-hmm. That's a scary guy.
And imagine if they said, we want 2 terabytes of data from Amazon on everything that's been done with IBM.
Well, we live in an era of big data. We live in an era where computing power is so extreme that they can process huge amounts of data very quickly and derive all sorts of interesting things from it. The government has lots of tools. Just leave us our encryption, please. Just please. That's all. You must use WhatsApp, Om. I mean, I'm sure that that's a tool for you, right?
I do. It's how I communicate with my parents. So.
Do you find it interesting that in one fell swoop, this Facebook-owned company has given strong encryption to a billion people, not just for text messaging, but for phone calls and video and audio?
Doesn't surprise me. I think that's the right way to do it. I think, the founder of WhatsApp, Jan Koum, is from a former Soviet republic, so he understands what, draconian, governments can do with information and data. And I think it's a very brave step for him to take, and I'm actually pretty excited that he did. I think the one aspect of all these encryption tools which are available right now, I think if you currently use any kind of encryption or any kind of technology like that, you get flagged for using it. And so you're actually creating a bigger issue for yourself if you're using encryption technologies. So this brute force approach to encryption and privacy and data collection is running roughshod on the rights of average people. I think that's a bigger challenge. And, I think in this debate about, security and terrorism and everything, the thing we are constantly forgetting is the basic rights of people.
Yeah. We're going to take a break. Om Malik is here, creator of Ginga Om, om.co. And you're still doing the weekend reading links, right? That's a great, great service to all of us. I love that.
It's on tinyletter.com/Om Malik.
tinyletter.com/Om Malik to subscribe. And you, by the way, congratulations. He's writing for The New Yorker now, which is freaking awesome.
Thank you.
That's got to be like a big bucket list item, right?
Yep.
one article in The New Yorker, I could rest. You actually wrote a really good one on photography. Photograph everything, see nothing. And I'd love to talk a little bit about that when we come back. Also here, Georgia Dow, we're going to ask you, Georgia, to defend Night Shift. Because I think this whole blue light thing is a bunch of bogosity. I know you don't.
This will be interesting then.
Yeah, I know you don't. Greg Farrow is, by the way, imore.com for Georgia Dow. But she also does, she does a lot of stuff on sleep. And you've got videos. What's the video site?
Sure. It's anxiety-videos.com. And on there, we have a video for people that may deal with insomnia. Plus, we have two new ones. We have one that's dealing with parenting and one that deals with restructuring negative thought patterns.
Oh, neat. Georgia, of course, a licensed family therapist in her real day job. And lots of good stuff on this. Parenting, too. How old's your kid? Is it five?
I have a 7-year-old and a 10-year-old.
7 and 10.
Two boys.
Oh, Lord. I used to have a pillow that said there's a special place in heaven for the mother of boys.
Yes.
It's true for every parent.
It's really true. I'm like a boy myself, though. I like video games and fighting and martial arts.
Yeah. So, by the way, you can kick their asses and we'll be able to continue to do so. Georgia's a Canadian champion in Brazilian jiu-jitsu. What? I'm sorry. You said you know what. I didn't mean to interrupt you. I'm so sorry, Georgia.
No. Renee's taught you some moves.
Yeah.
So I saw that.
I know how to do a chokehold.
You'll be able to defend it, yeah.
He tapped out, and I forgot to stop. Almost killed the poor boy.
It's really funny.
And we have a newbie in our midst, but he's already become a great contributor. It's really nice to have you, Greg, and I'm sure we'll see a lot more of you. Greg Farrow is the host of Packet Pushers, which you'll find at packetpushers.net. And I didn't realize this, security is part of your day job.
Well, mostly I do data networking for large FTSE 100 and Fortune 100 companies. But these days I'm a full-time podcaster and writer on technology, enterprise IT.
Yeah. And did you get your Twitter handle before Ethereal became Wireshark, or is it some other kind of Ethereal?
Wow, you do remember. Well, there you go. Yes. I did partly use the word ethereal for its spiritual aspects. Originally, I started out blogging on a different theme before I just shifted over to technology full time, and now I'm just a full time geek.
What's it say? Show us a shirt. We can't
see
it.
The shirt says
geek. Oh well, you must be one. You've got the shirt. Anyway, great to have you. Thank you for joining
Thanks
us.
So much.
Yeah. Our show today brought to you by Carbonite Online Backup. A big part of your security plan is having a good backup. You know, we talk a lot, especially on the radio show, about ransomware. It is gone. I mean, two more hospitals were hit by ransomware last week. It seems to me nobody who has an IT department should ever be hit by ransomware, and yet they are. And you know what the solution is? A good backup with versioning. If you want to know more about it, Carbonite has a great white paper on how you can use. Go to the carbonite.com and the resources section and look under white papers. Very good article about recovering from ransomware and preparing from ransomware. Ransomware Preparedness and Recovery Guide. And the key is a good backup with versioning. And that's what Carbonite is. Carbonite is a solution for home, for office. It gives an online backup, so your data is stored in the Carbonite cloud where it is safe. This is a great time to sign up if you've been hearing me talk about it, and I know you have because I talk about it a lot. Right now, if you use the offer code TWIT, you'll get two bonus months with your, first of all, try it for free. You get two free bonus months if you decide to buy, and right now, up to 30% off, so this is a really good time. The nice thing about Carbonite is you pay by the year. It's as little as $5, actually $4.99 a month for everything on an individual computer, Windows or Mac, home or office. And it's the most, and by the way, that's for an unlimited amount of data. It's the most affordable backup out there. So you've got to check it out. More than 1.5 million customers now in business and at home. I use it at home. And they have restored, and I love this stat, 50 billion files. That's 50 billion files that would have been lost without Carbonite. Carbonite.com. No credit card required for the free trial, but do use our offer code TWIT. That way you'll get two free bonus months when you buy. And take advantage of this 30% off. This is not going to last. Carbonite.com. And if you go to, again, resources white papers, you can read about the ransomware preparedness and recovery guide. And I know a lot of you in small business. Have any of your clients been hit by that, Greg, ransomware?
Not the ones that I know of, or... let's say none of that I can talk about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
I have friends.
That's an interesting answer.
I have friends who've been hit and have been publicly released information about it in the medical community. And the damage to those medical institutions was just
Isn't that
enormous.
Shocking? And what really shocks me, and I'm sure as an IT networking professional, it must shock you too, is that they did not have some form of backup. They had to pay the ransom.
Mm-hmm. So that doesn't surprise me at all. Medical institutions generally have a very confusing array of IT, and often it's not possible to have the systems fully under control. The doctors are going one way,
right?
Patients are going another way, the hospital administration's going another way, and often the backups aren't there. And those sort of cloud tools are a possibility, by the way. I mean, those Carbonite, that type of backup can certainly work, especially for small doctor surgeries.
It's a simple
solution. I would
highly
recommend it.
Yeah, yeah. You know, you don't want to pay these ransoms because that just encourages them. It's kind of not the ideal solution. And by the way, the $17,000 that hospital in Southern California paid is nothing compared to the government fines they're going to get for HIPAA violations. The loss of that data violates the federal HIPAA laws.
Yeah, I've always maintained that the best security strategy you can have is a media strategy. There's no way you'll be secure.
Right.
The only way, the best thing you can hope for is a strong recovery from a security event. And so plan a media strategy and then have a budget proposal ready once you get slammed with a security event.
I'm really curious what you all think about Revolve. This is, it seems to me, a black mark against Google. If Revolve made a home automation hub, R-E-V-O-L-V, no E on the end, looked like a little jar of hummus. And in fact, that's what one poster on Medium, Arlo Gilbert, called it. He wrote an article saying, the time that Tony Fadell sold me a container of hummus. Actually, Tony Fadell did not sell it to him. Revolve was a business. They sold a few of these. They were not inexpensive. There were several hundred bucks. Nest bought them. Of course, Nest is an Alphabet company. And Nest has announced that come May 15th, they're just going to turn it off. Even though you own the hardware, it will be non-functioning. They're essentially going to brick the hardware on May 15th by turning off the servers. The thing that I find very offensive is this hardware was billed, it said, guaranteed for life. Now, of course, you see that all the time. And one of the weasel words is, whose life? But and maybe the life was the life of this working life of this product. But never the, so legally, they probably get away with this. But it just seems to me such a mistake for Google, which already has a bad rap for discontinuing stuff like Google Reader, Google Wave, you know, the people use. Here's a case where people have been using this Revolve Hub. They spent $300 for it, may have spent many more hundreds of dollars, even thousands of dollars for devices that connect to it. And now it's going to be bricked. Is this bad for Google?
I would love to know how many people actually own this thing. I think this is way overblown story than anything else.
Even if it's five, though, even if it's a handful, the message Google's sending is not good. And how, you know what? If it is five, how much could it cost for Google to run a server in the closet that keeps this service alive?
I don't know the facts here on this product, but I can tell you that there isn't that many people who are actually probably using this product. That's why they took the decision. Secondly, I think when a startup sells out for money to other people, you know, they're essentially giving up control. And that's one thing everybody needs to know and remember when they buy a product from a startup.
So, you know, that sounds like you're saying whatever you do, don't buy a product from a startup if you want it to continue to work.
You should buy things being aware that, you know, the startup may sell out, the company may go out of business. You got to support the product because you actually love the product, not because, you know, for life. Life in technology products doesn't exist, man. I mean, that just is not real. I kind of find that, you know, Google may be at fault here, but also we don't have all the facts on this thing.
But does it matter that when you pay $300, they claim you have a lifetime subscription? I mean, that's what they say. Here's the good news about Revolve. There's no monthly subscriptions. You get a lifetime subscription with your $300 purchase.
And I think that the problem is that it was bought out by a big company. I would understand if you invest in a small company and, you know, they go out of business, they have a bad, you know, marketing scheme. And so you support a small business and you're like, you know what, there's a certain amount of risk there. But they were bought out by Google. Google's doing really well. There's no reason that they couldn't decide to continue supporting their product because, you, like, Google, as its name, it carries value, and a lot of bad press is bad for all of the stocks for Google.
That's what I think. I mean, I'm going to think twice about adopting a Google service because they seem to have a habit of pulling the plug on things. Doesn't that hurt them? So, by the way, because of the clamor, here's the EFF article. Nest reminds customers ownership ain't what it used to be. Because of this hubbub, Revolve is asking people to contact them on Twitter so we can work out something. And apparently they're offering a refund of the $300 price, which is great, except unless you paid for a lot of other stuff to work with it. They're asking that you email help@revolve.com so we can help you out during this transition and provide you with a refund. Is that enough? I feel like that's not enough. But I guess here's my moral. You tell me where I'm wrong, Om. The moral of this lesson is A, buy open source stuff that supports open standards so that you're not reliant on one company to continue to run the server. Very, you know, kind of important. And two, don't trust Google because they pull the plug on stuff right and left. And you know, thank God they haven't pulled the plug on Gmail or Google Voice yet, but it could happen any day now. Okay, I'm sorry.
Are you done, Leo?
I'm done.
I mean, I can't argue with you on that one. I think you're just angry about the stuff, you know. But you're right. They pulled the plug on a lot of things. But I also feel that in this case, you know, we don't have all the facts. I think it, getting outraged on Revolve is one thing. Yes, you know, Google Reader, that was bad. And I think the Nix software is another one where you know they're going to pull the plug on
that. Yeah, they're giving it away. That's nice. But I paid $300 for it. So, A, I don't get the freebie. And, B, you're right. They're obviously not going to develop it anymore. That's it. It's the end of life for that. So. And that's another company they bought. Now, they have SnapStream, which is their, you know, mobile version of the Nix software. And I'm sure Google will keep that up until they get bored with it. Somebody told me that the problem is structural. I'm trying to remember who I was talking to about this. Maybe it was Brad Sams from Petri. He said, here's what I deduced by talking to Google engineers is the way Google works. Tell me if I'm wrong, Om. The way Google works is engineers pick the things they want to work on. It's almost like, you know, you got to create a sexy project so you can get the best engineers at Google. And what happens is they work on this stuff because it's exciting and new. It gets released, and then they move on. And it's impossible to get an engineer at Google to stick around and maintain things because that's not sexy.
Well, that's been the problem with them for a while now. And I think that's why you're beginning to see the company become a little bit more careful and stringent about how they want to do things. There is more accountability. I think a lot of it is due to the new CFO. And she is actually making sure that there is more structure in this company. Like, yes, I've heard multiple times that people go off and do their own thing a lot. And as a result of that, there is a sometimes chaos, creative chaos is more like it.
Maybe start hiring people who like, you know, the security and 9-to-5 nature of just, you know, maintaining an existing product, just keeping it running
But they have a lot of creative people. Let's not forget that.
No, and that's good.
And I think that's where all the good ideas come from. I think the company is at that critical juncture where it needs to have a transition from, you know, this free-for-all structure to a more organized, more optimized way of running a business. But I think, you know, it's very hard to find the gap between creativity and bureaucracy. And I think, I mean, if there is any one company which can find it, it might be Google.
Yeah. I understand it's a challenge. And Google's goal is to stay nimble, stay innovative. But then there's a side effect to that, isn't there?
I think we're going to see a lot more of these, Leo, where IoT is just an emerging technology. It's roughly around about the 1920s where cars were. And there's no standards. None of them interoperate. There's no agreement between the vendors who make IoT technology. Philips light bulbs.
Right.
You know, for example, the Hue light bulbs live in a completely different ecosystem to Apple TVs. The two should work together. But instead, they're completely isolated. They don't. And aggressively, these people are building their own platforms to try and lock the competitors out from those sorts of things. To me, this is just the first of 100 of these going wrong. Startups getting early to market. You know, their technology will either founder as they run out of cash and their road drops off and they just run off a cliff, or they'll get acquired by big companies and the big companies either hire them for the people or the technology they're buying isn't compatible with the platform they've got. You're going to see hundreds of these and you're going to see a rejection from the market. That's people are going to say this IoT is rubbish. And then that's the dip, you know, the depression in the middle and before we go up into the slope of acceptance where IoT standards start to emerge.
Standards are key. And Google's working on standards. They've got Brillo and Weave and Thread.
And Jasper and Cisco and Philips and General Electric.
Everybody else is.
Ericsson, Nokia, right?
There's a dozen standards, yeah.
Oh, you want to go and look at what Nokia and Alcatel-Lucent and Ericsson are doing to build their 5G networks into IoT communication platforms so that IoT devices aren't connecting back to services in Amazon's cloud, but they're using active services provided by the 5G network that's in the standards that are being developed. And, you know, there's so much going on here that we have to fix in IoT. This is just the first casualty in a train wreck of Brobdingnagian proportions.
Wow.
I think the thing to remember is that, you know, we've gotten used to doing beta in software, and we are applying that same logic to hardware now.
Right.
And I think the average humans, you know, don't have an unlimited wallet to keep buying these things. So there is always a risk of you know, alienating the mass market by just, you know, coming to market too soon.
Yeah, and we do gain. Okay, all right. You calm me down. You talk me down. I mean, we gain something by this kind of quick iteration. We certainly have in software, but it means to me that people who are intrigued by the Internet of Things and the promise of these IoT devices, would they be better off waiting? And if they wait, then who funds the growth? Certainly many of us have learned not to put money into Kickstarter projects. I apparently haven't learned that, but
I think for now IoT is a completely nascent. It should be ignored by the mass market. There's no practical way that a normal person can take IoT and start to automate their house. I certainly aren't buying any of it because I've not been able to make any of it integrate. Without spending dozens of hours writing code and shims between different platforms, even fiddling with IFTT so that this thermostat talks to this controller that does this. You know, my life's too short for that sort of stupidity. I want to get on with something else.
It's like Internet of Tinkering more than anything else, not Internet of Things.
Yeah. Now I have two titles, potential titles, two candidate titles for the show. I was going to use a train wreck of Brobdingnagian proportions, by the way, the first to bring Jonathan Swift into the conversation. Thank you, Greg. And then what did you say?
Tinkering.
Tinkering. Thinking. I like that too. Tinkering thinking. and you know, Dr. Morbius in the chat room does have a good point. Light bulbs don't really need to be smart. They just need to show some light. Although I've seen speakers now. And light bulbs that can be controlled by the sunset using if this then that. And
it's kind of cool to be able to say Game of Thrones and my lights turn into red.
That's kind of cool.
Might do that.
Do you do that? You say
I am
the mother of dragons and everything gets red.
And then everything gets red. I do have a certain lighting scope depending on what I'm watching. It's just for the movie.
Look, it happened. I have that control too. Although in order to do that, I had to build a million-dollar studio and hire producers and engineers and lighting.
Yeah, but you have people that can turn the switches if things don't work. Yes, but do you say, I am the mother of dragons, and then does it work? That's what
Let
I
me
want
try
to
it. Well, let me see here. I am the mother of dragons. Whoa.
Oh. That's cool.
And if I'm suddenly naked because my clothes burn off, then you would know. Then you would know. Do they have Game of Thrones in the UK? They must, Greg.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You don't watch any TV, Om. That's why. You need to watch more TV.
How do you have so much time, Leo?
Because I get home from doing all these shows, and I'm in a coma, basically. And Lisa just props me up on the couch, turns on the TV, and gives me a feeding tube, and then I'm there for the next 12 hours.
Right. That's how you regen.
I regen that way.
Yeah.
You know, I just learned that dolphins only sleep with half of their brain at a time.
They do.
That's what I need to do. Half brain
sleeping.
You have
to be a dolphin, though.
Oh. But that's so that if, they don't fully go to sleep in case there's predators. Why do I wake up at 4 every morning? There's no predators. Or are there?
That's because you're using your tech at night.
No, yeah, but now, thank God, Apple's turned it orange, and so it will not wake me up. Is that true?
Okay, so let's go into this.
This is Night Shift. This is a new feature that arrived in iOS 9.3. It's the first time, in my opinion, Apple has fallen for the late night television blue blocker pitch. And they've decided to put blue blockers in their smartphone. What's the story?
So we do have a circadian rhythm, and that is really important to us feeling tired or not. And the couple of hours before sleep, when usually the sun would go down, and that's the way that our bodies have evolved, we would produce a lot of melatonin.
Right.
And melatonin is the natural transmitter that says, we're tired now, we can go to sleep.
Right.
Now, just recently, actually, in 1998, we ended up finding out on African tree frogs, clawed frogs, that there was another type of receptor that we had, which were called melopsin. And those are photolight receptors that react very strongly to blue wavelength light.
And are they in our eyeballs? Where are they?
They're only in our eyes.
Okay.
Like, that's it. There's, so, yes,
it's another, having, like, rod and cone? It's like another receptor in there somewhere?
Yes, it's the third receptor. Wow. And so that affects most strongly to blue wavelength light, so short wavelength light. And it will actually inhibit for hours the production of melatonin. And we need melatonin to fall asleep. So they've done, and this is not me, this is actually science. They've done hundreds.
Okay, there's another title. This is not me, this is actually science. I got to write these down because I'll forget them. Okay, go ahead.
There's hundreds of thousands of studies that have gone through sleep and why we sleep and how to sleep better. And so the best way would be just not to use your tech. It's not just that.
Well, that's, okay. So that's my point. If the tech is orange, you're still awake looking at Instagram at 3 in the morning.
You're still awake, and yes, you're probably getting, if it's something that's really intriguing and exciting, that's probably going to make you be more awake. Or if it makes you think or worry, if you're reading the discussion draft from, you know, the Feinstein bill, you're going to be more upset than you would doing something else.
Yeah.
But at least with it being larger wavelength of light, you're still producing more melatonin than you would if you were watching reading your phone as it would before, with all of this light going straight to inhibit the production of melatonin. And so the studies have shown that it works. Now, we haven't done studies yet on night shift in and of itself, but the studies have shown that using a dimmer light and using a light on a larger wavelength of spectrum does help more melatonin, less melatonin be inhibited so that you can fall asleep faster. And those studies have shown that.
Okay. I don't think we even knew, by the way, I don't think we even knew till photography came along that the sun was blue and the indoors was yellow. I think that our eyes adjust. It doesn't, you don't go outside and go, wow, it's blue out here, because our eyes adjust, our brains adjust.
Right. Well, and you get many wavelengths of light in the sun. It's not just, this is not like, you know, you're Superman and, you know, the yellow sun gives you power.
I would agree with you that, I mean, when I'm traveling, I try to walk in the sun, even, you know, trying to get my circadian rhythms, my diurnal rhythms synchronized to the clock of the place I'm. And so I would agree with you, bright light, sunlight definitely tells your body, oh, it's daytime. You know, I'm looking at some of these studies. Like, here's one. 14 people.
No, there's some big, huge studies.
Okay. This one has 14 normal subjects were exposed at night to a 60-minute bright light pulse between 1 and 2 a.m. while wearing orange lens glasses or gray lens glasses, and the amount of salivary melatonin, and by the way, I mean, it's 25%. It's not even a huge... And by the way, I take melatonin. It doesn't do crap.
Melatonin will only work for a few weeks. You cannot use this as a long-term sleep plan because your body will adjust.
Okay.
Right? So you're not going to produce melatonin if it's expecting you to get it from a secondary source.
I know. You are an actual sleep expert.
I'm not a sleep expert. I'm an anxiety specialist. So anxiety is my expertise.
Yeah, but anxiety is what's keeping me from sleeping. So
that's true. That's true. But probably most of that is because you have cycling thoughts that go through your head or your problem solving.
Right.
At the middle of the night.
I can't stop thinking.
Right. We're going to solve the problems of the world at night, which is the worst time to do it. And we don't have any distractions to keep us from thinking these thoughts. And so they plague us, which is another issue. But, you know, you might as well use night shift. Put it on the brightest setting. Eventually,
It makes everything look like I'm reading parchment paper.
No, but your eyes will adjust. The interesting, the really cool thing,
you
a lot of optical illusions will show this, we see white, what we assume should be white, we will end up, our brains will flip it and see it as whiter.
Yeah, you get used to it. And night shift gives you a slider. I just feel like this is Apple kind of.
No,
it's to me, this looks like Apple's desperate, frankly, for a new feature.
I've actually been sleeping better. And again, I'm a study of one. This is a case study.
Best thing to do would be put it away, not use it at all.
But I'm not going to put it away.
Ah.
Well, I've been using an app called Flux on my Mac.
F.Lux.
And it certainly worked for me. Now, two things. Whether it's actually worked.
That's a case study of two now, Leo.
whether it's worked because my screen's yellow and I can't see it anymore and tells me I actually should go to bed, or whether it's because there's blue light not hitting my cones, or maybe both. But I think there's two things. I do want to point out there's a wonderful, wonderful podcast called In Our Time, which is hosted on the BBC with Melvin Bragg on Circadian Rhythms. And they dive into this for 30 minutes, talking deeply around circadian rhythms and blue lights and this extra cones. And it's a truly fascinating article to listen to. If you do want to dive deeper into it, I could highly recommend that to you.
Didn't they do studies of people and they put them in caves where there was no indication of day or night?
Yeah.
And weird things happened, like they shifted into polyphasic sleep.
Yes, they do. We change our sleep habits as well. Without the cues of having a light source, we will sleep sometimes for 18 hours, then we'll sleep, be up for four. And so there is a huge shift without light. We do need that to kind of keep our body's clock in sync.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it may be that polyphasic sleep, the idea that you sleep in two shifts, one from when the sun goes down to about 4 hours in, say 11 or midnight, and then you're up for 4 hours and you sleep for another 4 hours, some think prior to electric lighting was the natural mode of sleep.
Yeah, there's been a lot of debate on that, on whether or not that's the proper way to sleep. There's a lot of people that do sleep that way, and it works out really well for them. Mm-hmm. And so, unfortunately, there's no real way to go back in time so that we can see what was the best way we slept. And it might have been very, very culturally influenced. So if there was things that you had to do in the middle of the night, a lot of dangers that were happening or something you'd have to do, that would be really important.
Apparently, according to the studies I've read, this is when people had sex.
Well, in the Samuel Pepys diary from the 1600s, he talks extensively about getting up at midnight or two in the morning to go and have a drink with his friends and come back to bed at 4 or 5 in the morning to sleep through. And
everybody was up at that time.
Wasn't that just so that his wife wouldn't know?
Pepys was a party animal. Everyone knows that.
That's just so you don't get caught.
Oma, how do you sleep, Om? You sleep well?
I sleep in about 5 hours a night and take a nap in the evening between 6 and 7:30, and then go out after that.
Is it the case people all over the world sleep roughly 8 hours between like 11 and 7 every? I mean, isn't that like this? Is that just a Western standard, or is that a standard worldwide?
No, I think pretty much everybody sleeps like that. Some people sleep less, some people sleep more. In my case, I actually. When I got sick, my doctor actually pointed out that the reason I had high blood pressure was because I was staying up too late. And that led to my body never actually clocking down and always being like, in a hyper mode. And that led to my blood pressure situation.
But also don't a little bit. Your doctor maybe, and maybe not, but that you might be a little bit or misunderstood to that, because it's not really about, it's more about the time that you spend to sleep. So some people are night owls and they like to sleep later. We've also found that there is a small group of people that really needs 2 to 4 hours of sleep, and that's exceptionally rare.
Not me.
Not me.
But I am a night owl. I like to stay up till 1 or 2 in the morning and sleep in the morning. That's kind of my natural
rhythm. You do so much, you're giving such an output during the day doing these shows and putting it all online. You need to also decompress.
That's also why I'm drunk.
That works. Yeah. Though that then will wake you up after 3 hours. So it's only a depressant for a certain amount of time.
I know,
and then
it
will actually wake you up. It doesn't work very well. Yeah. But what happens that will help for your blood pressure is that when you're sleeping through the night, our healing happens mostly when we're rested. So either low stress or when we're sleeping. So most of our cellular repair happens at night. Most of the working also on, so our brain uses up refuse. So it like brain poop. We do most of the cleansing of that also at night. Mm-hmm. So we get rid of beta, like amyloid plaques. Mm-hmm. And so that will lower your blood pressure as well. And that's why, and that happens more during the later part of your sleep. So if you're shorting yourself 2 hours of sleep, you're shorting yourself from two of the most important restorative hours of your sleep as well.
I think this is I think one of the reasons, you know, it's really interesting because whatever Silicon Valley is obsessed with, the nations of some, or maybe just our folk get obsessed with it too. It used to be that stand-up comics set the national agenda. It was all about airline peanuts. Now it's about things like we're not sleeping well, we're looking at the phones till the middle of the night. There's night shift. What's wrong with it? If you want to use it, use it. What's the big deal, right?
I just want to take the story to the right a little bit, but I've been having problems with sleeping and I've got a sleep disorder of a certain type and I've been attending a sleep clinic at my local
hospital. Wow.
And the thing that stunned me about it is just how tech savvy these people are. So, for example, when I was doing the diagnosis, I went to the hospital and they gave me this kit, which had a thing on my finger. I had to put a face mask on and then these bands, and they could actually calculate my heart rate, my oxygen levels, and how much my breathing. And so I took the kit home, plugged them all in, and then took them back the next day. They plugged it into the computer, took the data out, did a diagnosis instantly, and said, we think that you need this. And now they gave me a machine which blows air in my face. It's a horrendous thing. It takes weeks to get used to.
Wait a minute, it's like a fan?
You look cool. You look like Darth Vader. You sound like Darth Vader after, though. They're great.
Not a CPAP. You're not talking about that, are you?
That's right, one of those.
Okay.
But my CPAP machine has a 3G modem, and it dials all my data back to the hospital.
Oh, my God.
And the guy said to me, he said, if you don't use it, I'll know. So, and he can actually reprogram the machine from the hospital, so if he can see that the machine's not working.
And ladies and gentlemen, this is why national health will never be a part of the American lifestyle.
Well,
if you want to cheat, Greg, you can...
Do doctors in the UK have police powers? Can he come to your home?
Just imagine that. I was so stunned that these machines, I come in, I wear them, I take them back, the computer analyzes it, and now my medical team are actually monitoring my sleep through the CPAP machine because it dials up on a 3G modem every day. And I was just thinking, that is a real amazing advance in technology. Yeah. That doesn't happen in the US because CPAP and sleep disorders are only treated for 90 days under corporate healthcare.
Oh, that's interesting.
And
wow.
After that, you're on your own. Whereas in the UK, of course, it's a lifetime disorder.
It's a treatment for sleep apnea, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've only got a very mild sleep apnea. I've got some other problems as well, but I had cancer 30 years ago and various things. So my life's a little different.
That's a phrase you don't hear a lot. I had cancer 30 years ago. That's good on you. That's great. Yeah. Congratulations.
Yeah, I'm not dead yet. I'm not dead yet.
Man, this is this whole panel. Georgia, how's your health? Is it okay?
I'm good right now.
Okay, good.
Thank you. Like,
this panel is at death's door. So it's big CPAP data is what you're talking about.
I just was really surprised about this idea of using 3G for the medical equipment to report.
Yeah, no,
back.
That's cool. Yeah.
You know, and it's related to circadian rhythm. So once you've got a circadian rhythm disorder, and for me now I go to bed at the same time every night, more or less, regardless of whether I'm tired or not, and I'm a lot healthier than I used to be, partly because of flux and the blue light thing on my screen, which tells me to get the hell up and leave the bloody thing alone.
Did you follow doctor's orders? Are you now going to bed early and relaxing? And
yes, no machines in my bedroom. And
I think that's actually a good idea. So you like keep the phone and the laptop
everything
out?
Is in, yeah.
That's actually probably the
you
single.
You should even turn away your clock. Even if you're looking at a clock, you should turn that away so that you can't calculate. If you're looking in the middle of the night, everyone wakes up five times a night. Yeah. You go through a light wave, that's when you turn over or go to the washroom. Yeah. And if you're looking at the clock and calculating how much longer you have sleep or saying, oh God, I'm awake again at this time, that's making your waves hit, you know, stronger than beta waves. And so you'll wake up.
How about the Oculus Rift? Is it okay for me to put that on in the middle of the night or not? Is that going to wake me up?
The Oculus Rift is awesome, so I would say yes.
I'll go
playing that for a few nights.
I'll just do a little VR. That'll help me sleep.
We have a teardown of it.
Are you going to do Oculus?
Huh?
There's a teardown of it in the rundown.
A teardown of the Oculus Rift?
Yeah, you're not going to be able to get some sleep with that thing on.
We're getting the Vive next.
I'm getting the Vive.
Yeah, somebody told me, I think it was you, Jason, that there's a way to run the Vive and the Rift together.
Yeah, Upload VR, I think, is the site that did it.
Yeah, that's Scoble's site.
Yeah, Scoble's new site. They have a story about how they ran both simultaneously from the same PC. Different apps, different programs.
So now Lisa and I can both wear them at night.
Right. You could be watching Hulu, and she could be watching Netflix, and you could be chilling.
My husband has redone our entire upstairs for the Vive. Like, we've gotten rid of, like, we're
going to
get
a little
rid of
overexcited.
She's got rid of
he
sharp corners. And
yeah. No. All, like, there's nothing in the upstairs right now just for the Vive.
What?
And he watches videos constantly. We might need to have an intervention.
So do you have a Vive?
We've ordered it,
yeah,
so we don't have it yet. We're in Canada. We have to wait for everything.
No, I'm waiting too. If you didn't order it right away, they did start going out this week. Actually, let's take a break. Come back and talk about VR and AR and any kind of R you want to talk about. And your sleep and anything else that's on your mind. On Kickstarter, I ordered a floating bonsai tree. I'm excited about that.
Oh, I've seen it.
Yeah.
It's
using magnets to float the bonsai tree.
It looks amazing.
I'm sure I'll get that.
I have the Mars wave that's like amazing as well. It floats. It's like a speaker system that floats, and it's
you
got
a you have a
cool
Kickstarter habit as well. I can see.
Well, they sent it to me, but yeah.
Maybe that's my mistake. They know I'm an easy mark. They're not gonna send me anything. There it is.
Oh, I love it. That's amazing.
Can I have that in my room?
Yeah.
Bonsai. That's
not a
machine.
Relaxing.
It's very relaxing.
You can watch it grow. Count the leaves in the middle of the night.
Tick, tock.
Yes.
Tick, tock.
I would spin it, though. It would be a spinning bonsai.
Oh, yeah, you could do that.
So have you actually ordered it?
Yeah. Well, I kickstarted it, which means I may get it or may not. It's kind of the fun part of Kickstarter. It's kind of like a Russian roulette with gadgets. You might get it.
I always get sad when I don't get them, though. So that makes me.
Oh, I have a lot. I got over that. I have a lot of gadgets.
Did you? I still have been waiting for the ring clock.
Yeah.
The little clock that was the ring. It looked amazing.
Yeah. And then the worst, though, is you get it and it was just like crap.
Yes.
Like, I ordered these. There you go. See? I ordered these NFC rings. I don't know what I was thinking. But they have NFC in them, and you could, like.
What would you do with these rings?
I don't know. Swipe your phone on it or something. And then and then they put fingerprint locks on the phones, and I didn't need it anymore. I'm still waiting.
You have these cool rings. You can give them as gifts.
I'm still waiting for. I ordered 2 years ago a modular smartphone case for the iPhone 5S.
Oh, no.
And I may get it, but then who cares?
No, but now you can use
the
SE. iPhone 5. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the SE. Our show today brought to you by Stamps.com. If you are going to the post office for any reason whatsoever, but especially if you're going for business, you should know about Stamps.com. Look, the Postal Service is great. I mean, they deliver. The problem is you got a job to do. You're selling on eBay or Etsy or Amazon, and you want to fulfill that. Or maybe you're sending out invoices or brochures. You don't want to go to wait in line for stamps, or worse, please don't go out and get a postage meter. Those things are ridiculous. They charge you for the ink, and they rent. Stamps.com, you use your computer and your printer and no special ink, and you just print the postage. You can buy and print official U.S. postage for anything at all, letters, postcards, packages. They have a USB scale, which means you will always get exactly the right postage. And you can print right on the envelopes with not just the address that you're sending it to, but your return address is automatically printed on there, your company logo if you want. Stamps.com. I love the scale. Here's Carly opening up the scale. This is part of our special offer. So it's a USB scale. You plug it into your USB port. The exact amount of postage you need will appear on your computer screen. And it even does things like suggest alternatives. Like, it'll say, well, is this a book? You could send it media mail and save a buck. You're going to really like this. There are things you can do with Stamps.com, discounts you can get that you can't get anywhere else. It will import your existing address books. It will get the address of your buyer from Amazon or Etsy or eBay, or I think like 50 different pages. You could get certified mail forms automatically printed, international customs forms automatically printed, taking the information right from the web page. You can print postage from inside Microsoft Word. So you can be writing a letter, print the postage, do it all. It's just great. Here's the deal. Go to stamps.com. It will make your business look more professional. Use our promo code TWIT, and you're going to get a special offer. Click that microphone in the upper right-hand corner. Type in TWIT, T-W-I-T, and you'll get a four-week trial of stamps.com, plus $110 worth of stuff. You get $55 in free postage. Yeah, I know. You get the digital scale for free. You do pay shipping and handling. I think it's $5 on that. But to make that up, they give you a $5 supply kit and, of course, a month of stamps.com. That's a really good trial. Go to stamps.com, click the microphone, type in TWIT. If you use the Postal Service, you absolutely ought to be using stamps.com. It's awesome. Stamps.com, don't forget the offer code, is TWIT. What are you thinking about these days, O'Malik? I shouldn't be the only one setting up the, queuing up the pins for your bowling ball.
What do you mean?
I don't know what I mean. I have no idea what I mean. I need sleep. I mean, what are you doing these days, O'Malik? What are you working on? What is this?
I love the line.
It just doesn't work. It didn't work. It was I could tell halfway through it wasn't going to work, but I was stuck.
I love that you went fully for it.
Well, though, you have to. You can't just say, oh, never mind. You have to finish the sentence, as bad as it might be. See, that's nice about, that's nice about being a writer, is you can backspace and start another metaphor.
It's your show. You can do whatever you want.
When you write for The New Yorker, they're famous for their facts. Do they still have fact-checking?
I think they do.
A lot of places, they got rid of fact-checking.
A lot of places got rid of facts.
Yeah, that's true, too.
Our presidential candidates got rid of facts.
Yeah, who needs facts?
Yeah, the facts.
Like Mashable this week.
Oh, my God, what happened?
Mashable just completely wiped out any original content on politics.
30 people, including the New York Times editor who jumped ship to go over there. Wow. Do you have any insight? Of course, Ohm's been through this a little bit.
is mean. That is just
mean. I'm sorry. Yeah.
You're getting back at me now. I know.
No. I don't mean to bring up anything painful. By the way, when you click on Jim Roberts' biography on Mashable, he became executive editor and chief content officer, left the New York Times to do this. When you click on his biography, this is what you get. So I don't think he works there anymore. Is any insight, anybody, on what happened there? Nothing.
From what I read, they were going to go all into video.
Oh.
Like, they want to become very much like BuzzFeed and do short-form video because, you know, video is where all the dollars are now.
Isn't there a risk, though, for any journalistic enterprise just chasing what's big today? I hate to see them do that because, you know, BuzzFeed and Vice are already there, right?
No, but, like, they're going back to what they were known for, writing about technology, social technology, right, social services and stuff.
No more
like
politics,
that.
No more news.
Yeah, and I think they were not known for politics and news per right. se, and it makes sense for them to go back to their roots. You kind of feel for people who lost their jobs, but
yes,
from a business standpoint, I think this is a more logical move for them to make. But the world is just like, you know, you have to be very focused on what you're good at. And they were just all over the map as a service.
Yet I felt like maybe, and I'm obviously wrong, but I felt like I saw Mashable links everywhere. I mean, they seemed like they were, you know, really getting the word out. A lot of sharing. Maybe right to focus on the viral content. But
I think, you know, the thing, you see their links everywhere. I don't know who told me this. It's somewhat like, you know, things appear larger on social media than they really are.
Ah, that's true.
And I think a lot of the times we forget the reality is very, very different. And yeah, I think that's where, you know, it'd be interesting to see how they come back to their core and how well they come back to their core. You know, I think as a neutral bystander, I'm looking forward to what happens there next.
It is a very, it is a very volatile market right now. Now we're staring at Facebook's F8 conference coming at us on Tuesday. Facebook increasingly dominating this market, and I would, you know, this Mashable move has a lot to do with, you know, how do you get drive traffic on Facebook, and sites like BuzzFeed and I would say even Vice, much less interested in driving traffic to their homepage. They don't care. BuzzFeed doesn't even have a homepage anymore, right?
Well, they do.
But they don't expect you to go to it.
They don't. But, like, I think their whole model has been a very atomized way of, spreading their content. So they're doing a good job. I think, you know, both Vox and BuzzFeed have done a good job, and so has Mike. And I'll tell you, the biggest challenge for all these companies is going to be on Facebook, is that they will all be competing for the same space on the newsfeed as everybody else. And I think it becomes very challenging. And what I mean by everybody else, it means your baby posts, your advertising, your music posts from Spotify, and all those things which go into your feed, is everything is going to have an equal amount of ranking, and that's going to cause, you know, all these services to have a moment of reckoning. I think the news organizations who are heavily dependent on Facebook will have a moment of reckoning, in my opinion.
Facebook itself struggling a little bit, according to an exclusive in the Information, Amir Efrati writing that they're suffering from a decline in original sharing, that in fact it isn't the baby pictures anymore, that fewer people are posting on Facebook, more personal content's now going to Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, and other places. In some ways, perhaps, the news service is pushing out the personal content. And I have to say, I see that on my Facebook page, absolutely. What I used to be a place I'd go to catch up on family and friends is really now a news feed.
I love that image there.
Which of Mark Zuckerberg?
The one down at the bottom, right there.
Facebook 2005, a beach with people playing volleyball. And now it looks like Times Square. I don't know if that's quite fair. It says about 57% of Facebook users who use the app every week post at least once in a given week. This is confidential data that the Information got a hold of. But only 39% of weekly active users post original content. A lot of it is reposts, reshares. And 6% of weekly active people posted to a specific group of friends as opposed to the news feed. So people aren't using those friends lists. They're just posting.
I think the article highlights the fact that it's the next generation who are not using Facebook. So
right.
Younger people under 25 have already abandoned Facebook for other platforms. And that's the problem that Facebook has got.
Well, it's not that they're abandoning it. They're still there, but they're not posting.
No. And no, they're not using it either. So in the first world, so Europe and America, so recently I gave a talk at a school about social media and being safe online and things like that. It was a wide forum. There's about 500 kids in the room. And I said to them, how many people here use Facebook? And they all put their hands up. I said, how many of you have posted on it in the last week? And no one put their hands up.
Yeah, exactly.
They don't put anything on Facebook because grandma's watching, right? They don't want to put pictures of them kissing their boyfriend of 2 weeks.
Well, also, they're using Snapchat. You only have so much time. And if they're really using Snapchat, which I bet they are, right?
Yeah. My teenage daughters are using... I have two teenage daughters, one's 15, one's 18, and their consumption of Snapchat boggles my mind. They will make like 250 posts a day on Snapchat. They'll literally just take a photo of themselves endlessly every 10 minutes or continuously post or react or like. But they don't put that on Facebook because Facebook lasts forever as Snapchat goes away. It's a conversation. And I think Facebook's missing out on the fact that all of media is a conversation. It's two-way. It's not broadcast. And what Facebook's trying to be is a platform that pushes it out. I know also, like our podcast, we work directly with big companies with billion-dollar marketing budgets. And their problem is that their marketing has to compete in the Facebook newsfeed with news articles, baby photos, and so forth. And they cannot find a way to make Facebook work for them with that money. Facebook's problem is coming at it from multiple points of view. Now, keep in mind that Facebook has got plenty of growth. Indonesia, India, China, you know, wherever you want to be, there's plenty of growth going on in those countries as new adopters come on. But I do sometimes wonder if Facebook's reaching a mature phase in some markets where the high dollar value is as people start to fight to get into that feed. And this is where media is coming a cropper, because it's competing as much with marketing efforts as news efforts, as Mashable producing, you know, low quality video rubbish that drive click-throughs, as anything else. And then eventually you end up with free newspaper being distributed on the underground on us every day.
Go ahead, Adam. You
know, I think there is one counter point to that in 2014, average time spent on Facebook per month was 40 minutes, and in 2015, it was 46 minutes. So even with an increased number of users and decreased number of original, a decreased quantity of original content, we've had more usage in Facebook, regardless of how we all feel about it.
Go ahead.
I also feel that, as a service, I think if there is anyone who can figure out how to find the ideal blend, it would be them, because of all the data they have. And from what I'm pretty confident of that.
It seems like Facebook is looking to get more content from media than ever before. They started the live video streaming this week through the iPhone. Anybody can stream live, and they've announced that they're going to allow advertising. They're encouraging, with Facebook articles that people post to Facebook. I thought it was very interesting, that Medium announced that a lot of news sites like The All are going to move to Medium. And then Medium has tools to automatically do instant articles on Facebook and AMP, Google's sped up browser, built in. So if you're a news publisher, you don't need a content management system. You just have everybody post on your Medium page, and it'll automatically go to instant articles. It'll automatically be AMPed. I think that's really an interesting play. It feels like there's a move from mainstream or traditional media onto these platforms that, of course, it's pushing out, teenagers who are just going to use Snapchat anyway. But they're not I think your point is well taken. They're not abandoning Facebook. They're just not contributing to it. They're reading it.
My reaction to that would be is that Facebook has, usage of the Facebook feed has dropped, but that's been offset by usage in Instagram. Tools like Instagram or Messenger is a separate app. I'd love to get hold of the data and drill in and say, have people replaced feed time, the news feed, with time spent in Instagram or in Messenger using it as a telephone call system, or whether there's some sort of actual... I would think, given the discussions I've had, is that feed time has dropped dramatically, but people are spending more time engaging with the Facebook as an audio tool or as a picture tool.
Right.
I think that they have to be really careful. When you see the people that use the internet the most, which are teens, they use the greatest time on the internet and social media, and they're the ones that are not adopting to Facebook, being active, participating members, more like that's the way that they check in, their grandparents check in to make sure that they're okay, or they send family messages. I think that that's something that Facebook is trying to still be trendy with the next generation of users. And so I think that they have a little bit of a competition in versus Snapchat is cool, trendy, fun, effortless. They don't have to worry. They can post almost anything without worrying about retribution.
Right.
Whereas they look at Facebook as this is your parents watching you the entire time. And so we have to be careful using it. So they don't have that same amount of fun and or freedom. Plus, Facebook's privacy policies have given people a little bit of pause. And I think that these are the issues that are slowly coming back to kind of haunt them.
It's not just parents, too. It's teachers, employers, insurance companies.
That's a very good point. Yeah.
Your future employer, your past employers, anything. Mm-hmm. You can even get calendar systems that automatically look up somebody's Facebook account and tells you where they're working now. Or LinkedIn.
Right. That day that you said you were sick, we see pictures of you on the beach.
Well, Facebook, you know, we're going to watch with great interest what they say at F8. I mean, one of the things that supposedly they'll be introducing at F8 is a chatbot platform that they're going to. It just feels like Facebook is in many ways going more towards a corporate publishers, corporate content. This chatbot platform isn't for end users. It's for, well, it is in a way. It's for end users to communicate with big companies. So they're going to, they have developers that they're going to connect the big companies with who will create bots for these big companies. So when you need customer support or you want to buy something, you can go into Messenger and say, hey, LL Bean, I need a couple of pairs of moccasins. And a bot will respond to you. I find that
sounds like such a nightmare.
But that is so
I love calling a company and talking to a real person.
Oh, get over it, because that ain't you. That's going away. You see how hard they make it for you. Press 6.
I just keep on dialing. Dial 1 1,000 times, right. Or 0 1,000 times, zero. And eventually, hope for a human.
Some human will appear. Say, what do you want? I'm busy. According to CNBC, Michelle Castillo writing on the CNBC page, the NFL went to Twitter and not Facebook because, and this is from sources who spoke on the condition of anonymity, the NFL felt Facebook undervalued content rights and had a poor monetization model. So the NFL, I mean, Facebook Live was built for something like the NFL, but Thursday Night Football is going to be, oddly enough, on Twitter. Twitter is going to stream 10 games next season. And where it would have probably more naturally gone to Facebook. I don't know how Twitter's going to stream the NFL. That makes no sense at all.
Twitter's got more money than Facebook. That's all that says.
No, it says a source with knowledge of Facebook's. They only spent $10 million, and they had, according to other stories, there were offers to the NFL for $15
million. For one game versus, but there was.
For 10 games. A million a game.
Yeah, well, it's a million a game versus when, you know, like CNB, like another.
Oh, it's much
like
more for broadcast.
Game. It's like $17 million, right, for one game.
So this ain't about money. So, this is about digital platforms and thinking ahead to the future.
But where's it going to play?
In the Twitter feed.
Just in the Twitter feed.
I don't know. I'm asking. Yeah, maybe on Periscope. I don't know.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
There'll be vertical video of the 50-yard line, and you'll be, I don't know.
Yeah.
A source with, according to CNBC, a source with knowledge of Facebook's thinking said the social network was the one to back out of the NFL offer, not the other way around. The main point of contention was over the value of non-exclusive, and that's the point, live-streamed games, which are also widely available on TV. So it doesn't mean Thursday Night Football will only be on Twitter. Amazon also backed out of the deal, leaving Twitter as one of the last players standing. So there's some dispute. A spokesman for the NFL strongly disputed this claim. So just more.
But who would want to watch, like, if you're going to watch, like, besides if you were at work, which I can understand that you're going to use anything or right. Twitter in that purpose, but wouldn't you want to watch it if you could on a big screen?
Is this true, Om, that Mumbai has outlawed, I'm sorry, you prefer Bombay, has outlawed selfies?
I don't know. That would be so hard to do.
There were so selfies.
I was in India a week ago visiting my parents, and my people are obsessed with selfies. I mean, they do crazy things when it comes to selfies, and it's unbelievable how good they are at selfies.
The problem is 19 people have died in India taking selfies. The total worldwide death toll of selfies is 49. And most of these deaths, by the way, are 21-year-old men who are climbing on things. I think the state of New York has banned selfies with tigers. Not allowed. I'm not kidding. You think I'm joking.
But wouldn't taking any picture next to a tiger be dangerous?
Yes.
Like, is it really the selfie? Or just don't take a photo. Don't get that close to a tiger is the real lesson that we need. Don't climb on things and then let go of one hand.
It's interesting that, I mean, you understand why I say, for instance, the city of Pamplona, Spain may ban selfies during the running of the bulls. Hey, look at me. I'm a, ow! But why the state of New York decided that they needed to make a law against tiger selfies In New York, taking selfies with tigers is banned by state law. But
you know, I did run the Pamplona Bulls.
Did you? Did you wear a little red scarf? And...
Oh, yeah.
What were you thinking? What a stupid... I'm sorry.
I wasn't I think I was drunk. Great, Greg. What do you think? I was 22.
But
I
that's
no
the problem. That's who dies taking selfies is 21-year-old men. This is another one. Very popular. You take your selfies while you're walking on architectural masterpieces way high up in the air. What? This is so stupid. Don't do this. How about this one? There's a guy taking a photo with a tiger and for some reason, we don't know he's doing the heavy metal.
Well, so would using a GoPro be any better, though?
I don't think it mentions the kind of camera. I don't think it says, you know.
I think in many ways, selfie deaths are proof that Darwin exists.
Yes, I agree. Survival of the least of the fittest.
I'm waiting for VR accidents. People wearing VR things are going to fall over and kill themselves in their houses.
That's true. I'm actually a little bit scared.
Your husband.
My husband. Myself, too. I'm very excited about it. But on our room, we have, there's stairs near where it is. So we're going to have to coordinate off so that when we're, you know, playing a really scary game, running away from a monster, even though on the HTC Vive, when you get close to a wall, it'll show you the wall. But I think that I may go into panic mode and just jump over to the stairs and hurt myself anyways. So that might happen.
I love our Oculus Rift. We actually didn't own a Windows machine powerful enough, so we had to build one, which we did on the new screensavers. We finished it yesterday, actually, finally added the monitor and stuff. But we got the Oculus Rift last week, and I can't wait to get the Vive. I think you were right to buy the Vive because the Vive has the handles. Ooh.
We have both. We're going to be getting the Oculus Rift as well. it's for work.
Sure.
But what I love about the Vive is exactly as you mentioned, Leo, is that you have your one is it's going to be able to see the outside of you, and plus you're being able to use your hands instead of using a controller. Plus walking around is going to be so much cooler on the Vive. So I'm excited for both, though. I'm okay with either.
And thanks to our chat room, here is a video of a girl taking a selfie and getting hit on the head with a tuba. So, don't. Stop it. okay, back to VR. I'm sorry. It seems almost as if the tech industry is trying to find ways for us to creatively off ourselves. it is really fun. So I played, and it's funny because it's games that you would normally not play, like Lucky's Tale, which is a fox jumping around. It's a platformer kind of. But as soon as you're in this cartoon world and you can look around, it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool.
You have a video
of me playing the game?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, of course. You just want to mock me. This is the game. This is called, but see, you see it in 2D, it's not as much fun. But when you're actually in there
as Lucky. You jumping around.
I don't know if they've shot video of that. I try to do it when nobody's around.
That's what we need.
Yeah.
I want you to see playing Alien Isolation.
He has the keys. He comes in late at night and does it when we're not here.
I do it late at night. Hey, speaking of selfies, by the way, the monkey selfie.
Yes.
Courts ruled that he's filing an appeal.
The monkey is?
Yes. The courts ruled that a monkey can't actually own his own selfie. He is now appealing this in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. Lawsuit was brought by PETA on behalf of Naruto, who is a crested Sulawesi macaque, against the nature photographer David Slater. See, Slater published the picture in a book, saying that Naruto took the picture of himself, which is obvious if you look at his sheepish expression.
Of course, it's obvious.
I'm a macaque.
lower court. So lawyers claim the monkey owns the copyright and that the photographer, Slater, and the publishing company have infringed on it. The lower court dismissed the suit, saying animals don't have the standing to sue under the Copyright Act. Apparently based on a Ninth Circuit case called that is named Cetacean versus Bush. A self-appointed attorney for all the world's whales, porpoises, and dolphins sued the Navy for using a sonar system harmful to marine mammals. That was thrown out. So now the appeals court is going to hear the appeal by the macaque, who says, no, I own this. And I don't know what he's going to do with the royalties.
If he can,
I'm so glad that technology has come this far.
I'm thinking buying a banana farm. I don't know.
Technology has brought this advancement, this disruption to the law system. It's just amazing. I mean, how far can technology go?
Do you think judges must go, oh, my God, how do I get a better job? How do I get out of here? This is
but my question terrible. Is, if he can't give you the rights to the selfie, then how can he sue? It seems like if he can sue, then he, you know, maybe they got a little paw print from the monkey to say, listen, he said it's okay.
I'd be pissed if I were the photographer. I mean, if the photographer is not there and sets up the camera, I mean, I don't know what happened. Would the monkey steal his camera? Is that how we got the selfie?
He pressed
the story
himself.
Is that the monkey took the camera and...
And then went... Bleh.
Yeah, and was looking at it.
And David got a great picture, yeah. Right? It's in focus and everything.
This Week in Law covered it extensively.
No, really?
Yeah. Not recently. A couple of
months. Oh, yeah, because it's old news
ago.
Now. Yeah. Well, it's back. The monkey's appealing. Actually, this ties into your New Yorker article, doesn't it, Om?
It does.
Tell us about that. So the title of the article was Photograph Everything, See Nothing.
So the article came about when I read the news that Nick Software was going free.
Yeah.
And the first thought that went through my mind was, oh, well, they don't want to publicly announce they're killing it.
Right.
But this is what it is pointing to. They're going to kill this. And they means Google. But when I thought about it, it made perfect sense that, you know, they're doing this because, you know, we take so many photos now as average human beings, you know, that we don't have enough time to edit these pictures the way we used to edit them. You know, first we used to, you know, develop the pictures inside dark rooms.
Right.
Then we went to like desktop software like Photoshop and Lightroom and Nick software. And now we just keep taking photos. And the whole, the idea of photography has left the realm of, human scale. And it's got into a scale where only way to make sense of our libraries, edit all these pictures, find the best ones, find the most magical moments, we need to end up using, you know, artificial intelligence and machines. And from that standpoint, you know, we don't really will look at everything. We will just have all the photos edited and surfaced for us automatically by hardware. And if you look
that's
at
what Google's doing, isn't it? I mean, that's kind of the
exactly
idea.
I would not be surprised that all the things which are great about Nick software end up in Google
right.
Photos.
Right.
And I think this is a logical progression. And that's what I argue in my piece, that we should not get upset about the shift, but it is the logical progression for photography. We are no longer making photos from an aesthetic, artistic standpoint. And now we are making photos as essentially part of our everyday language and everyday memory.
I see, you know, I mean, this is the image that you used in the article of people at a concert and everybody's got the phone and taking pictures. I see this kind of stuff and I wonder, when are they going to ever look at that? They are right. Not enjoying the concert. They are busy taking a picture. And I can almost promise you that once they Instagram one shot to show their unlucky friends how lucky they are to be at this show, they will never look at any of those images, especially the video, again.
But if you look at it, if you take a step back and you're looking at this and saying, well, I was at this concert, that's essentially, this photo is like a text saying
photos or it didn't happen. Yeah.
And so it's like photos are very much like bookmarks of life.
I think that you're right about it's being something that you can look back on and remember it. But I think that we also end up, you know, we spend so much time, you know, wanting to plaster our moments around social networks that we're not really in these moments ourselves. We're not really enjoying the concert and how it feels because we're so busy trying to take that perfect picture that's going to make our friends jealous or that we're going to be able to show to grandma. That I always worry about us being in the immediacy of being zen and in the moment. Everyone's trying to get ahead, getting a better shot. And so you want to, you know, sometimes I'm like, you know, put the phone down and just like be there.
I think that's one aspect of it, right? I think if you sometimes you see something in a store, you take a picture of that. You see something mm-hmm. on the wall yeah. written in a magazine, you just take a picture of that. So this is, you know, I think the behavior around photography is changing. I don't think it's about making photographs. It's about, you know, capturing visual data from a sensor. Right.
How do you feel about this life logging thing? Gordon Bell very famously was doing it. In fact, wrote a book on it. There's a company, I bought this one, another great Kickstarter investment, called Narrative, that you wear this clip-on camera, and every 30 seconds, it just takes pictures and uploads them to a server. So you basically have pictures. The reason I stopped wearing it is the pictures were always like of somebody's navel because it's on your it's not good pictures, but your whole life is recorded in pictures. Mike Elgin, who also wears one of these dopey narrative clips, wrote an article or an opinion piece in Computer World this week. Life logging is dead for now. He was talking to Gordon Bell, who kind of invented this, even wrote a book on it. He said it was, Gordon called it his My Life Bits project. Gordon was one of the chief scientists at Digital Equipment. He was at Microsoft when he created this. He said, "Oh, I don't do it anymore. it's not something that's bringing a lot of value to my life." He says we're overloaded with data, and the public is suffering from data fatigue. We don't need any more pictures of our life. We don't want them. And by the way, if we needed them, we've got the camera phone to take them.
I think most of my life would be of me sitting on the couch. I think.
Well, you know, Gordon
might
was
be depressing.
Gordon was also influenced by his wife Gwen, who was a wonderful person. She founded the Computer History Museum in San Jose and suffered towards the end from Alzheimer's, couldn't remember anything. And one of the things that I think really interested Gordon was this idea of, well, if you won't be able to remember it, but your camera will, and you can go back through your life, whether it's just yesterday and see what you did, or 10 years ago, or 50 years ago, and see your life that way. And he thought that would be kind of interesting.
Might be great if you are interesting. Or you had an interesting life.
Nobody is. Nobody. But, even the most interesting person, it turns out their life is pretty dull.
Yes. I mean, I spent a couple of years traveling through Africa and the Middle East. And I had took in the days of film, a 35mm camera and took photos occasionally. Most of the time I didn't get it out because the camera was actually quite valuable and people would want to steal it. When you're traveling through third world countries, getting a camera out is pretty difficult. But I've got enough photos. They're all weird. They're all badly framed. They're not exposed. At some point, I dropped the camera and the left-hand side went out of focus. But I have the photos there to give me memories. And today, what I do with photos, which I think is to Ohm's point, he makes a good point about what we're doing, is the relationship with photography is changing from rigid photos to something that's just a stream. But I record a photo in my day one. I have a daily logger app on my iPhone. And, you know, recently I was in Las Vegas to do a podcast recording session and I just got the phone out, took some photos of the hotel room, photos of the hotel, of the recording sessions, of the people I was with, and they automatically get caught into a diary app and they're there. And every now and then as I'm scrolling through the diary app, I see them again. Instead of writing an article, you know, like a 300 words on what happened today and what I'm thinking, I just took a photo. And anytime I need to see it, I can go back to that that day, click on it, and there's my geo tag, there's the photo, and I can remember what I was doing that day, and the memories are still there for me. And that's all that's the only thing I take photos of. I'm not a photographer, I don't expect to be. I'm a worst photographer ever, and I'll never own a camera again. It'll just be my smartphone.
It feels like we're maybe a little more self-obsessed than we really ought to be. I don't know.
I think that you're probably right. We're getting worse for becoming a little bit more need for immediacy, fame, and narcissism. But I think that as Amon and Greg were mentioning, it isn't, if you're going to use it just to catalog and to use that as, you know, your way of writing your story to be able to remember, to be able to log something, then I think that that's nice. I think that social media has pushed that everyone has to have, and it makes other people feel like they're lacking. I have a lot of people come into my sessions saying, you know what, I'm looking at everyone else's life on Facebook, which leads to a lot of depression because you put onto Facebook on social media these great moments. And so everyone thinks that everyone else is doing so much, and then they reflect yes. upon themselves and say, you know what, I'm doing so little, and look at this person, they're climbing this yes. mountain, this person's shark diving, you know, someone else is, Greg's running with the bulls, and here I am at home on the couch, I'm watching Game of Thrones, and how I wish that I could be doing these things as well. And so we need to kind of also put things into perspective that, you know, most people's lives are not like this. And
I wish I could be sitting on the couch watching Game of Thrones with you, actually. That's what I'd rather.
A lot of fun.
No, I do that, though. I look at Instagram, and sometimes it's depressing because everybody seems to be having more fun than I am.
Yeah, but people aren't going to post pictures of themselves, you know.
Boring.
Going shopping.
Okay, let's make a pact. Georgia, you and I will post pictures of ourselves sitting on the couch.
I'll do it tonight.
From now on.
Leo, I've got there's a great app for you if you want to get into it, Leo. It's called 1 Second Every Day. And what it does, it goes through your camera roll, and it picks 1 second of footage from every day, and it creates a timeline
video. Randomly.
Randomly.
That could be dangerous. That could be dangerous.
Yeah, no kidding. I take pictures I don't.
Myself yeah. I don't want to see again.
There's reasons I didn't post that on Instagram.
You can edit them, exactly. though. You can edit which
one. All right, here's another one. This is one this is Mike Elgin wrote about in Computer World. Gordon Bell's on the advisory board of this. Digi.me, D-I-G-I.me. This goes out. It's an app. It's a free app, but you can. There are premium versions that will get more of your data and will get everything you post, everything you do. The internet of me, okay? Oh. Solipsistic. So you and you download the app, and it gathers everything. So you have the internet of you. Okay, Georgia and I, we're going to make people feel better about themselves. No makeup. My hair will be in curlers. I will be sitting on the couch in my underwear watching reruns.
Okay, you said it. You said it.
Every day.
I don't know about every day. I'll do one today. I'll do one today.
You first.
I'll tag you on it.
You first.
I'll be eating ice cream.
What you do is
I'll be in my snuggies.
To make it fair, just pick a moment in time. 6:42 p.m.
No.
Yeah, and whatever you're doing, it's 6:42 p.m.
No, that's too dangerous. I don't think that's a good idea. And then I'll arrange to be skydiving at 6:42. And something like
just
that.
Just to make me feel bad.
Just to make
I'm
Georgia. Yeah.
Rollers.
Yeah, I know.
Well,
no.
And she's got 24 hours
Here's
to step
deal.
Up her game.
You have to take a picture of yourself at the least desirable moment. Like you want the picture will make people feel good about themselves.
Yes.
A selfie designed to make other people feel good. Like you've got your face buried in Ben and Jerry's and your hair's sticking up. Right?
A selfie to make sure that I lose as many Twitter followers as possible.
Yeah, see, nobody's going to do
that. I understand.
Exactly. Nobody's going to do that because they're afraid of losing followers. Exactly.
I'm good. I'm good for that. I'll do it. Don't worry. I don't have that many.
All right, let's take a break. We're going to come back with more. Om Malik is here. Georgia Dow from iMore. It's great to have you. And, of course, our newest, a newbie, who is fitting in quite well, Greg Farrow from Packet Pushers. Tell us a little bit about Packet Pushers, packetpushers.net.
Oh, well, Packet Pushers is a deeply nerdy show on data networking. That is building internetworks of computers globally and in enterprise IT. We've been doing it for about 5 years. We've done over 450 shows, and it's now my full-time business. We have a hell of a lot of fun producing different sorts of content. We work with a lot of the biggest enterprise IT companies as well as the startup market to bring their message to the audience. But what we try and do is focus on the technology, not the product.
Nice. Fun.
So it's a
real pleasure meeting you. Thank you for being a part of the show today.
I'm looking forward to coming and meeting you next time I'm
Good.
In the Valley.
And I think you'll be back. Our show today brought to you by GoToMeeting. Be a meeting MVP. No matter where you are, you can get your work done. You can have those meetings you have to have for business. You could even, I don't know, be watching the NBA. A lot of people around here are very interested in the Golden State Warriors right now. Why bother going to work? You can hold that meeting in a bar. With GoToMeeting, you start a meeting with one click. It makes it easy to meet with your team anywhere, anytime, even from a mobile device, even from your iPad. You can actually present from your iPad. Use your webcam to see your colleagues in high-def video. Really is as good as being there. Share your screen so that you're on the same page. Great for collaborating on documents, making a presentation. I love it for, you know, sales presentations are great because it's easy for you. It's easy for your client. And, you know, to be honest, I think a lot of people think, oh, I got to fly out, take the client to lunch, blah, blah, blah. That's really old school. The client doesn't want that. Client wants to get in and get out. Just show me what you got. And this makes it easy. If you want to do presentations together, you can pass off presenter duties easily. And you can even, if you want to be, you know, the wiseacre in the back of the class, you could send private chats and video links during the presentations. GoToMeeting, it really steps up your meeting game. It is a must-have. Be a meeting MVP. Start your free 30-day trial right now. GoToMeeting.com. Free. No credit card or anything. Just press that button. You'll be up and running in minutes. Your first meeting ready to go. You just send people a link. They click the link. It's easy for them. It's easy for you. It is the way to meet. GoToMeeting.com.
I'm just going to jump in there, Leo. GoToMeeting is my favorite platform for that. I've been using it now for 5 years and can highly recommend GoToMeeting to people. I've tried all the other platforms that are out there, and GoToMeeting still remains my favorite.
You know, we're not paying you extra for saying that.
I know you're not, but okay, I really good. Want to see if the other ones nice. Go away, because I keep having to use them and I know. Them.
I really and, hate that, actually, when somebody says, oh, we're going to use product X, and I go, oh. Yeah. Please, no.
I've got to use this, and I'm going like, oh, and it wants to install a plugin, and then it wants to.
So who's going to buy Yahoo? Yahoo has decided to let the clock tick a little bit longer. They are for sale. There's a deal book out. People have seen it. It's circulating around. They've decided to take bids through April 18th now. And lots of rumors about who might buy them. I think the inside track goes to Verizon, which, of course, bought AOL recently. SoftBank, perhaps, the big Japanese investment arm. Some have said Google's interested. According to Kara Swisher, who probably knows all, she says, the truth is the mergers and acquisition unit at Google crunched the numbers as they should, but an offer is highly unlikely. She says AT&T lukewarm. And now this just in, it would be pretty funny. The Daily Mail in the UK. What? Greg, tell us about the Daily Mail.
So the Daily Mail is a phenomenally huge media platform. They do a lot of, it's called a tabloid. It's very big on putting together beat up headlines.
I've been told that if I see a story in the Daily Mail, I should not repeat it.
That's generally a good idea, and also question the validity of the truth.
Exactly, yes.
If you think BuzzFeed invented the catchy headline, these guys were doing it years and years ago in the days of real media and have done for like 30 years. They get an astonishing amount of traffic. I can't remember the numbers off the top of my head, but it's absolutely like one of the top five web properties in the world. And if for them to get onto Yahoo means they want that content platform to drive more. The same reason that Verizon's in the ring, although – my understanding about Verizon is that they're exploiting the network as a way of generating higher revenues around the ad tech. That is, by buying AOL and HuffPo a few years ago, Verizon was able to get much better ad tech play because they can see people traversing the Verizon network and as well as what's happening on the actual site itself.
Huge value to that, isn't there? Yeah.
Well, there's a $24 billion market in carriers selling data to the ad tech brokers about the traffic that's crossing. So your personal data is identified on the internet, on those MPLS backbones, on those fat pipes, and they sell that data for billions and billions of dollars worth of revenue every single year. So if Verizon can use that to and to know how much money these ad tech companies are making, then it makes sense for Verizon to throw its hat in the ring for Yahoo as well, because now it gets to see the content and the network, and they can exploit that data science to give you the ads that you really want to see and drive much more revenue out of the network, not just as selling bandwidth.
Clearly, the Daily Mail's already doing that because I just went to the Daily Mail. It's a UK publication, but they clearly know that I'm coming in from the US because every story in here is US focused. I doubt anybody in the UK knows Megyn Kelly from Fox News, but of course, she's been written quite a bit about because of her feud with Donald Trump. And here are some paparazzi pictures of Megyn Kelly. That's on the top. The New Orleans Saint football player who was killed in a road rage incident yesterday. The female Texas teacher who was arrested after being caught repeatedly hitting a male student around the head, then mocking him when he complains. That's all U.S. stories. Now, I bet you that's not what you see if you go to the Daily Mail's website.
Absolutely not. I'm seeing a completely different. Yeah. A boy who learned golf in a sheep field wins the Masters. Obviously, well, that's some sort of sports ball thing.
Sports ball, but, yeah. What do you think Yahoo's worth, and who should buy Yahoo? Or is this just a fire sale and it's just the end of the line?
I don't think it's a fire sale. I think Verizon is probably the most likely buyer here, because of all the reasons Greg's just mentioned. And I think they will probably make a very reasonable bid for this company. I think that data brokerage business is huge. I think people are still struggling to figure out how to tie web data with mobile users. And I think this is another way of Verizon to be able to bridge that gap of mobile and web information. So, if I was a betting man, I would bet pretty hard on Verizon. My number two pick would be Time Warner. I think Time Warner also has a reasonable shot at making a play for Yahoo, though I don't think they have that kind of, the money power as Verizon has. So I would pay close attention to those two. I think that the number of people who use Yahoo on a daily basis, the traffic, has some value for companies like Verizon and Time Warner. But if it was it is not a growing business. It's a growing business for people who actually have something to tie it to. And I think Verizon is the best bet.
So you're not buying Yahoo's content sites. You're not quite buying its audience. You're buying data.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, that's what it really is all about.
Isn't that interesting? And just because they have such massive traffic, they have a lot of interesting data about their users.
That's right.
Wow.
That's all most media sites are. They're data sources for tracking you across the internet, and that data is very valuable and can be exploited for money. Media companies have been making money off ads, but ads have become tracking tools about your behavior.
Yeah.
Say that we track the ad so that we can show you the best quality ad, but what we actually want to be able to do is target you in multiple ways, not just one way.
Boy, it really is an interesting reformulation of what content is, of what journalism is.
Content is really just a way of generating data science or data lakes of information.
That's so depressing.
That we can then feed into the algorithms to extract, metadata and trends and analysis.
What is that data worth, though, if it's not about showing ads? What else would we do with that?
Today, they're using it for political science. They're using it for medical health research, sentiment analysis. Marketing companies are using it to determine whether people are responding to ad campaigns or trending. Are people talking about their products in public? Are people, is the audience engaging with your brand in some way? I mean, are people mentioning Coca-Cola on Twitter? Are people talking about your router, your Revolve, or your IoT strategy? That sort of sentiment analysis is huge in terms of being able to say, I ran a marketing strategy. I've just spent. Have you seen there was a video this week from the guy who owns the Game of War, one of the top five games on the iTunes store. And he was talking that they're now spending over $500 million a year in spend on promoting that game in the iTunes and the Android app stores. It's now one of the second or third largest. It's making over $2 billion a year in revenue. And he built his own media and ad tech team because he fundamentally believes that the media companies are all lying, stealing, thieving buggers. And he wants them to stop. He doesn't trust them to deliver ads. And he has to justify every single spend. So he has his own ways of tracking all of that sentiment. And he just basically said that I get all the data about when it's delivered. I know when people react to that and buy my game and make money for me. And I will no longer trust media. All he wants is a way to know if his marketing is actually generating a return.
Last year, in 4 months, Game of War spent $40 million on its Kate Upton campaign. I'm sure many of you saw those ads. $10 million a month. And that's a free app. Although you might have also seen stories about, like, the one a couple of years ago, the Belgian teenager who spent $46,000 on Game of War merchandise in the Game of War store for a free app. And as somebody who's personally spent $300 on Simpsons donuts, I kind of understand how that
once
is.
Once you get hooked on that, you just can't stop.
This is actually a serious issue. It's addictive, and these guys are designing games to be as addictive as possible, right, Georgia? I mean, they're using serious addiction theory to grab you and keep you.
Oh yeah, and it makes a killing. I spent $2.99 just yesterday on $2.99 on Candy Crush, and I said I was never going to spend any more money on it, and I did because I wanted to pass that level. Unfortunately, games can give you the same amount of addiction as cocaine can, and it gives you this one immediacy. Two, it gives you a rush of dopamine, which makes you feel good and powerful, and we like that feeling, and it's a great avoidance technique. So instead of doing your taxes, you're going to play a video game instead and feel a little bit better about it. Yeah. And so the games can market off of that and keep us coming back for more by giving you just a little bit of dopamine, and it ends up being, you know, the same thing like the guy around the corner saying,
it's a Skinner box, as Beatmaster said. Skinner, B.F. Skinner, the father of operant conditioning, showed that rats would press a button forever to the point of death if you just gave them a little reward every once in a while. Average of, well, look at this. There's a headline from April Fool's Day, but this one's true. Game of War's paying players spent an average of $550 each in 2015. Is it that good a game? No, but it's not about that. In fact, I would be willing to bet that most people who play games like this, I know I'm one of them, didn't really enjoy it. Felt bad about it. I realized when I was getting up in the morning to harvest my crops in Wii Rule every morning that there was something wrong.
Yeah.
And I deleted that game.
Good for you.
So Game of War's number one. I got to download that and try it.
You probably shouldn't. Don't do it.
Kate Upton, they ought to pay her more money. Because, by the way, she's not in that game.
She looks fabulous in the advertisement.
Yeah, where's that buxom young lady in the game? Nowhere. So, why didn't Yahoo just do this themselves? Why are they, isn't this a strategy that could have kept them alive? Mine that data, sell it to Game of War people.
I think the Yahoo data, just by Yahoo data, wasn't that valuable. I think when combined with Verizon's data, it is more valuable. When combined with HuffPo and Tech, but the AOL, it's a lot more valuable.
But so, couldn't they have just, or maybe they still will, do a deal and just say, well, we'll sell you the data? Or maybe they just don't want to be in the business anymore. Just say, you take it. They could probably get a better exit. Actually, this, come to think of it, this is really being forced by activist investors on the board. The board itself have all thrown in the towel, and they're saying, let's just get what we can for it. Right?
It seems like it. I think one of the articles I wrote about Yahoo was pointing out that, like, you know, all social services and all web services have an expiration date. I think you grow older with your audience. I think you see that happening with Facebook.
Oh, that's right interesting.
Now. Like just like television services and the music services, everything just, you know, the audience grows older, and when you get older, you become less, you know, attractive to advertisers, and
right.
The new behaviors of the internet are elsewhere. So the attention shifts. The attention shift means you become less relevant. So it's not like Yahoo is dying. It's just becoming less and less relevant by the day. And as a result of that, its value keeps going down. And I think that's where they're at. Like, their relevance to the modern web is very little, except for they're selling this data around their own users, which is like the crummiest position to be in.
That's a really, see again, Om, you really can, you're at a higher level of understanding of what's going on. And I think you kind of nailed it, which particularly for content companies, you have an age cohort that you appeal to, and you age with, they age with you and you age with them. And there's no way of turning back the clock. Somebody you knew is going to come along and get the 20-year-old. And that's so what, basically I should just retire now.
You seem to be defying time.
You're like, Leo, you're like Madonna. You're evolving with the time.
Ah. I'm going to do a video with dwarves and fire and just...
A dragon.
Dragon. Now, I think that there are content categories. If you don't try to be trendy, there are content categories that have some interest that can continue to generate new audience. Our audience is not aging, as far as we can tell, and in our research. But that's because our audience is not about geography. It's not about demographics. It's about people who are interested in a particular thing, technology, and using technology. And as long as people are interested in that, I hope. I mean, I don't want to do this forever. And I don't expect to sell the company. I think it'll die out a natural death. But I'd hate to. I don't want it to be premature. Interesting.
I think podcasting is really beginning to take off. So,
oh, good. Thank God. Oh, my God. It's about time.
Well, I mean, it's not exactly a hockey stick of excitement that, you know, we're not going to be. But the research that I've been reading up, you know, from Neiman Lab and various places is that there's a steady trajectory of growth. I mean,
I don't think that's good for us, to be honest with you. I think that that's brought in competition. We dominated for so long, and I think now there's a lot of choices in the podcast space, and I think that that's brought in competition.
It's true. Well, everyone and their dog has
us.
A podcast.
Yeah, it's diluted.
Yeah, makes it harder to find sponsorship.
Our audiences are not audience. Going down. Our audiences are going up, but the ad dollar is diluted.
Yeah.
So that means there's what's unfortunate, and maybe this will be fixed, ad spend has not gone up with the increase in interest in podcasts. You would think that, you know, Procter & Gamble and, you know, big companies would start going to podcast advertising as their mainstream media advertising starts to become less efficient and less effective. But they're not. There's not. I don't think there's been an overall increase in the pool. There's just been a larger number of people splitting the pool. But maybe that'll change.
I think, you know, the advertising grows at the rate of the GDP. It doesn't grow any
faster. Interesting.
So if you look at it, it's just a little, very tiny variance on the GDP growth and advertising dollar growth. So, you know, I think a lot of what you're seeing is more competition for same amount of dollars. And I think people who have the most amount of attention are getting most amount of dollars. That being people like Facebook and Google are sucking up most of the digital dollars. YouTube is taking a lot of the digital dollars. And some of the television dollars are going to, you know, places like YouTube, podcasts,
right.
and so, you know, this is just a you know, the slicing and dicing of the pie is changing. And I'm, you know, I don't think, you know, folks like you have anything to worry about, because you serve a very strong niche with a very strong point of view, and you actually remember who you are. I think, you know, we talked about Mashable a little while ago, as sometimes when you go, you know, too far away from your core, you lose your core audience and you actually start to dilute why people come to you. I think the reason to come to Leo hasn't changed in last, you know, close to 16, 17 years, in a sense.
Yeah. I think you're right.
I watched you on screensavers. You were very current then, and I watch you now, and you're very current. And I think that is what will keep you in business, by being, you know, regenerating yourself by the day. I think that's technology.
I'd like to say that I'm smart enough not to have tried to be trendy or follow the trends, but I think it's really just that I'm lazy. And I'm not really interested in innovating in any way. I just want to keep doing it, you know.
Well, I tell you what I'm waiting for, Leo. I'm waiting for radio to shut down. I think that
there may be a big transfer of money at that point, won't there?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think there was an article today talking about one of the biggest radio networks in the U.S. is actually on the edge of bankruptcy. And
yeah, that's the one I work for, by the way. It's $20 billion in debt. Yes. How do you get $20 billion in debt? Who gives you money? After the first few billion, who gives you more money? Well,
we've got to double down. That's called venture capitalism.
So, yeah, that's a Clear Channel. The syndicator of my radio show is Premier, which is a Clear Channel division. It's $20 billion in debt and owes some significant, you know, balloon payments.
And I think also when
it's
we
a terrible business. You don't want to be in the radio business these days.
And I'm also hopeful
for my
business, in terms of when we start seeing podcast hardware in cars. So today people consume radio shows in the car.
No, as soon as smartphones and Bluetooth were ubiquitous, that was it for radio. And that was the growth of podcasting, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I believe so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most of the people listen to a podcast while they're doing something else and driving.
Driving's big.
That's a great time. Yeah.
Yep. Ira Glass, who does This American Life, which is probably the greatest radio show of all time, has made a pretty good transition from radio only to radio plus podcast, spoke at South by Southwest a couple of weeks ago. He gave one of the closing talks. He says, it's a boom time for podcast advertising. He says, CPMs, the cost for 1,000 impressions, sometimes reach $50 to $60 for ads. It's crazy. It's amazing. It's unbelievable. This is a quote. It's boom time. It's a bubble. What Ira doesn't know is we've been charging that much for about 10 years now. So I hope it's not a bubble, because you know what happens to bubbles.
Yeah.
They burst. I don't like to be trendy. Look what I'm wearing, a cardigan. I'm just, you know, I'm basically saying I'm an old man. It's cold. I'm going to have soup for dinner, then take a selfie on the sofa while I eat my Ben and Jerry's.
You don't have to say it, Leo.
I mean, look at me. I'm not wearing my bathrobe today. I actually put a shirt on and brushed my hair.
For all we know, you're not even wearing pants.
That's a great part of podcasting.
Greg Farrow, Packet Pushers. Everybody should listen. PacketPushers.net from iMore. And what is your podcast, The Vector?
We do isometric podcast, which we're...
Well, you only do geometry?
We do. No, it's a gaming podcast.
Oh, okay.
Now we're calling it Disruption. Okay. And also we have the iMore show.
An iMore show. And of course, you've got to go to anxiety-videos.com because there's some great, great stuff there, I got to say. Also with us, Om Malik from Om.co. We'll wrap things up in just a little bit. But before we do, I do want to let you know that we had some fun this week on Twit, and we have created a small movie for you to watch so that you can enjoy.
Watch. Previously on Twit.
A new sofa, the Lift Bit, answers the world's most critical feature request by adding smartphone control support.
I can't hear the money. I can't hear the price. I'm too busy dancing with the feelings.
Triangulation.
We're talking to Bill Atkinson, the creator of QuickDraw, of Mac Paint, of HyperCard.
It's an interesting thing about the employee numbers. Wozniak took employee number one, and Steve took employee number zero. He'd be coming down the hall and we say, here comes the big zero.
This week in computer hardware.
HP announces the world's thinnest laptop, the Spectre 13.3, 10.4 millimeters. That's as thin as a AAA battery. But that looks like an absolutely, utterly impressive piece of engineering.
Yep.
This week in Google.
Revolve. This is pissing me off. Nest has announced that they're going to shut it down. After May 15th, we'll no longer open. The hub won't work. You guys have demonstrated to everybody the real vulnerability of Internet of Things stuff. If it needs a server, you got a piece of hardware that doesn't work.
You want the definition of what's evil? This is evil.
Twit. Technology isn't always pretty, but we are.
Just got an idea. Brilliant. This is my new show. Hot Tub Tech Machine. Live from Leo's Hot Tub. So if I have Robert Scoble come out, we'll get in the hot tub together and we'll do... Wouldn't that be a good show?
Ooh, forbidden visual.
Maybe not. We got a big week ahead, too. Jason Howell has the deets.
Thanks, Leo. Here's a look at a few of the stories, anyways, that we're going to be kind of keeping an eye on in the week ahead. Tuesday, April 12th. It's kind of a big day. A couple of big things happening. First of all, HTC is going to be having... hopefully, what is expected to be its flagship announcement for its new lineup of phones. Is it the HTC 10? You know, we don't know. We're going to find out on Tuesday. Might have a 5.15-inch display, a Snapdragon 820 processor. Is it going to save HTC? That's always the big question here. We're going to find out on Tuesday. Also, starting Tuesday and going through Wednesday, April 13th, is Facebook's F8 Developer Conference. Lots of things that Facebook's going to show off there, including chatbots and Messenger and so much more. Leo and myself are actually going to be on hand on Tuesday, April 12th from 10 to 11 a.m. Pacific here at twit.tv/live to kind of talk about the kind of the keynote from the event and all of the implications there. And then, of course, later in the day on Tech News Today, we're going to talk all about it. So you'll want to check that out. Don't forget, Megan Moroney and I do Tech News Today every Monday through Friday at 4 p.m. Pacific at twit.tv/live. So you should definitely check that out to see all the things that are happening in the world of tech news. That is about it for now. Back to you, Leo.
Thank you, Jason Howell. Jason, as he mentioned, will join me and Gina Trapani Tuesday morning around 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern time, 1700 UTC for our live coverage of the first of two keynotes at Facebook's F8 Developer Conference. If it turns out that we think there's more on Wednesday, there's a second keynote, we'll cover that live as well. It's never, you never can tell. Sometimes the second keynote is just, you know, very developer-y. But I'm really interested in what Facebook has to say about this bot and messaging platform. I really feel like they have the inside track because so many people use Messenger. Almost a billion active users now, which is mind-boggling. Hey, we were talking about sleep a little bit earlier. Our sponsor for this portion of the show, Casper, the best mattress ever! An online retailer of premium mattresses for a fraction of the cost. Why? Because they make their mattresses beautifully, obsessively engineered mattresses in the U.S., and then instead of putting them in a showroom and having to mark them up for that middleman, they sell them direct to you. And, you know, I think when they probably pitched this, I would like to see their deck, because I bet it was kind of like, look, no, we know people want to lie on mattresses in the showroom. No, we know that. And we know that shipping a mattress, that's crazy talk. You're going to ship a king size, but we figured this out. And they have. So first of all, lying on a mattress in a showroom is no way to choose a mattress. I know that. I've bought many a bad mattress because you can't really get into it, you know, on a showroom floor. There's, everybody's looking at you. There's bright lights. But with the Casper, you have 100 nights. You have 100 nights to lie on that mattress so that, you know, if you don't like it, anytime in the first 100 days you call them, they'll come and get it. They'll take it away and refund you every penny. It also, as you can see, it comes in a very compact box. That's a queen-size mattress fit in the easy box. That's really great. It's why I got one for my son at college, because it was very easy to get upstairs in the dorm room. And by the way, he really appreciated having a nice, fresh mattress in the dorm room. And because they're inexpensive, it was a great thing. It was worth it for 4 years. We also, I sleep every night on my Casper pillow. Last night, I said, where's my Casper pillow? Lisa said, I put it, we were watching TV, I have it in this couch. I got up, out of bed, walked to the living room to get my Casper pillow, because I have to have it. It is the best. Dual layer, responsive, but comfortable, but cool. And by the way, that's another thing. I love the coolness. I think, and I think, Georgia, you confirm this, that one of the problems people have with sleeping is they get too hot. You need to stay cool. And these mattresses breathe. Beautiful.
And they're so comfortable.
Oh, you know.
I do. I've even jumped on a Casper mattress at CES 2 years ago. They have great spring, and you do want something to be cool underneath you, and yeah. they're going to sleep better if, you know, you have a nice, cool, dark cave.
Ooh, cool, dark cave. Sounds good. Get your Casper right now. $50 off when you use our promo code TWIT at Casper, CASPER.com/TWIT. $50 off. Terms and conditions apply. For details, visit Casper.com/terms. Just remember to use the promo code TWIT for an outstanding price on the best mattress you will ever have from Casper. A couple of final stories as we wrap up TWIT for this week. James Comey, the director of the FBI, in an offhanded comment during a Q&A session at a speech at Kenyon College, admitted he puts tape over his webcam. The director of the FBI is worried about somebody spying on him.
I think the amazing part about this is not that he does it, but his excuse for doing it is because he saw other people doing it.
He saw some guy.
Yeah.
He says, I saw something in the news, so I copied it. I put a piece of tape over the camera because I saw somebody smarter than I am had a piece of tape over their camera. I don't know even what this means. It's mind-boggling. Hey, Greg, unplug and replug your headset. And the show's gone on long enough now that we've fried your...
Yep.
There's some memory leak in the chip in some of these headsets. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I apologize.
No, it's better. No, it's not your fault, man. Don't blame yourself. It's USB.
Wordy.
WordPress.com, right on. HTTPS encryption turned on for all of its websites. If you host your site on WordPress.com, that is a great thing. You don't have to do anything. It's just there. It's on. I think you might have to check a box. And they're using Let's Encrypt, which is a really cool project that anybody who's running their own website should look into, that will get you an SSL certificate free. And
it's an amazing service.
Isn't it great? And Let's Encrypt, now it works. I'm trying to do it on my Mac. Maybe I can get you, Greg, to consult. it comes with these scripts, which is great. So it's really an automated process. And if you're using Apache, boom, bada ding, bada boom, it's very easy. If you're using Nginx, a little bit harder. And apparently on a Mac, it's like very sketch. But for most people who are running Apache on a LAMP stack, this is a very easy way to get a free cert and be HTTPS.
Yep. So the people who are involved in Let's Encrypt jumped onto Apache very early because that's the most widely used server. But Nginx is a little bit behind it. But there's quite a few articles out there now on how to use your favorite tool.
Oh, good.
To reprovision. Now, the key there, of course, is that your Let's Encrypt only issues a certificate for 90 days. It does that, of course, to ensure so that certificate validation or that certificate revocation is not required. So you have to refresh the certificate every 90 days. So that requires you to automate it, and that requires you to have a script that automatically runs. Apache does that. And now there are tools available for more and more of the web servers as Let's Encrypt becomes so obviously dominant in the market.
So you could just kind of have a cron job that every 3 months gets a new cert.
Indeed. And then you also have in the cron job validations to check that the certificate's updated and then alert you if it doesn't, and, you know, the whole range of things.
Yeah.
But all of those things are happening. Yes, Let's Encrypt, fantastic project. And more importantly, Let's Encrypt is supported by a number of commercial companies, and we should thank them for contributing money to push that
Absolutely.
Project.
Including WordPress.
Yes.
Mozilla.
Cisco.
Yep.
Like, you know, companies who actually have big money are actually supporting this project.
They announced about a month ago that they had issued 1 million certs so far. And that's
awesome.
Well,
that 90-day thing I talked about
that's
is going
part
to
of the
drive
reason.
A lot of those.
Yeah.
You're going to see an awful lot of certificates issued. They're going to have staggering numbers.
Yeah. They're doing 100,000 certificates a week. OVH, WordPress.com, Gandhi, DreamHost, and DigitalOcean also support HTTPS using Let's Encrypt. So that's fantastic. Did you see, and what do you think of, the Brave browser? Speaking of Mozilla, Brendan Eich, who was the founder of Mozilla, one of the founders of Mozilla, has created a new browser called Brave. It's nice, but it does something that, the newspaper publishers aren't real happy about. It comes with not only with a built-in ad blocker, but it replaces
the third-party ads with ads from its own inventory, ads from advertisers who don't use tracking and honor the do not track setting. Then Brave takes a little bit, takes a taste, and then shares the rest of the revenue with publishers and users, and they say on better terms than the publishers are getting from their own ad networks. That's not good enough for the Newspaper Publishers of America. 17 members called Brave blatantly illegal. Blatantly illegal. I'll explain why that's not true. And a plan to steal content and threaten a lawsuit. Ike responded, I think, with something that probably worth mentioning, which is browsers, and I'm reading directly from his post, do not just play back recorded pixels from the publisher's sites. They're the end user agent, the software you run on your computer that mediates and combines all those little bits of content, including ads and news stories, and displays them on your screen. The content is published as documents, HTML markup, with the intent not of specifying how the content is presented. The browsers are free and do, in fact, rearrange, ignore, mash up, and otherwise make use of content from any source to deliver that page to you on the screen. If it were the case, he said, that Brave's browsers perform republication, as the newspapers suggest, then, well, then so does Safari's reader mode, or any browser with an ad blocker. Or, I don't know, do you use links on your command line? That does it too. So do screen readers for blind users. That's what a browser does. A browser is software you run that, you, at your request, goes out and fetches content from sites and displays it however you gosh darn want it. Disagree? Agree?
No, not at all. I think you have yet another proof that media companies are technology illiterate. They have not been able to keep up with technology and are actually unable to understand the reality of the world today. I think you look at why Facebook and Google control their destiny is because they were not paying attention to the bigger trends at play. I think that is where media has fallen, and I think, this is just another example of it. It's like, look, did you read the story on Forbes where
perfect example.
Yeah, like they're spreading malware. It's like,
so let me this is a great one. So Forbes, when you go to Forbes.com with an ad blocker on, it says, "Oh, this is how we make money. Please turn off your ad blocker." And I don't know if Forbes, a lot of sites are now doing this where you can't read the site. Does Forbes let you in, or does it just beg you to turn it off?
No, it doesn't let you in.
It won't let you in. So you go, oh, well, I guess I have to turn off my ad blocker. And then what happens? Well, Forbes ad tech software allows automated purchase of banner ads. And oh, lo and behold, malware has been injected into your computer from an automated ad, a flash ad on the Forbes site. The irony.
Mm. the editor of Forbes.com wrote a long piece defending Forbes after I went after them on Twitter. And my comment was something like, friends don't let friends
use
read
Forbes.
Stuff from Forbes. And like, and it was, and I used to work for Forbes.com.
Forbes was good content.
Whatever. I'm not going to talk about the merits of the content. I think the fact that they were spreading malware was on them, right?
Yeah.
That's something, and he wrote a long, almost 2,000 word piece defending why I was wrong and Forbes was right.
Yeah.
Well, lo and behold, they're doing this again. And it's the same thing, Economist did, which was like accidentally served up malware. And it's like, if you're going to take advertising, if you're going to make advertising your key source of income, at least, be careful to pay attention to the fact that it could damage your end customers, also your end customers, not just advertisers, but also the readers. So, I think media had it coming for them, in my opinion.
It really
is
a shame.
I think the part that really upsets me about the Forbes thing is that as soon as the malware appeared, they go, oh, it's not our responsibility. It's our third-party ad tech suppliers. But it's your brand that's actually at play here. And as Ohm is exactly right. Not only are media companies tech companies, every company is a tech company in 2016. And the companies that are failing are the ones who don't understand that IT and the technology that drives it is your key competitive advantage, or it's your survival mechanism as the industry changes, as technology changes everything. And media companies are just one example of that. I mean, look at their rush to get onto the platform of Medium. Now, Medium's able to even talk about becoming a publishing platform for the old media companies because they don't want to be technology companies. They don't want to understand the internet. They don't want to understand ad tech. They don't want to hire developers and write platforms. And yet, you look at the media companies who are successful, and they're the ones who have invested heavily in IT teams, in technology people, hiring the right resources and in spending on, you know, technology and so forth. They're the ones that are winning. And the ones that have failed are the companies like Forbes who say, oh, we're not a technology company. We're just about content. And, you know, even earlier today we talked about Yahoo is selling itself to Verizon. Well, what's Verizon? A technology company.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like newspaper publishers and networks. They're the dinosaurs in the room. Like, they have to evolve with the way of things or die off. And so, you know, they really have to get with the way that things are changing and understand that.
So I want to end the show with a hat tip to robots and automated technology. A couple of great upbeat stories. Here are trucks, which have crossed, what is it, all of Europe, I think, autonomously. Or not exactly. They have one truck with a driver in front who has Wi-Fi, and he led a convoy of trucks across Europe with no drivers in the back, just him.
No, they all had drivers.
They had drivers? Oh, that's no fun. Yeah. But they couldn't touch the wheel?
The drivers would... had to be there for safety.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was basically when they're on the highway, the trucks are able to use the white lines on the road to steer themselves and to reach the optimal condition. So because they... See how
they're
in the video they're drafting each other and saving up to 20% of emissions and fuel.
Look at that.
And that's all done by computer. The driver's actually just sitting there resting. It can only run on a motorway, and only if the motorway is in good condition with perfect white lines to operate.
And please don't get in between the trucks, because they'll squish you. I would hate to run into this convoy. How many trucks were it? Three?
Well, there was four different manufacturers in the article it talks about, and they all had a competition to drive across.
Oh, okay.
But they're not, it's not like Google's car or any of this other stuff. They're fully manned. The self-drive mode only works on the highway. It's more like cruise control.
Yeah, but there's always some Italian in a Fiat who has to get in between. I don't know why that is. Get out of the way.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, that's story number one. The other good news story comes, of course, from SpaceX, which did it for the first time. They were able to. They launched, of course, the Dragon to bring 7,000 pounds of cargo to the space station. And what SpaceX has been trying to do is get these boosters back after they're used up. And they were able to land the booster upright on a barge. Same music, oddly enough, as the trucks. maybe that tab's still open. And there it is. The robots are winning, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, it was so much fun. I took an extra 40 minutes of your time. I thank you for being so generous. Ohm Malik from Ohm.co. You are the greatest at Ohm, the best Twitter handle ever. Should I say Ohm or Ohm?
You were doing it right. Ohm.
I like Ohm because it's like my mantra. You are my mantra.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. When I think of you when I meditate. A happy little Ohm. Hey, it's great to have you, Ohm. Great. Always a pleasure to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. Thanks also to the wonderful Georgia and her videos. We've got to show you Georgia Dow's videos at anxiety-videos.com. Videos now on parenting, on, of course, anxiety, and on getting a better night's sleep. And Georgia and her partner do these, and she is a trained professional, so don't try this at home. Oh, no, do try this at home. Do try this at home. Right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
And do you know when you're getting your Vive?
June.
Oh, yeah, man.
It's way too long. It's way too long. I've actually written to them to say, like, please, can you send, I'll do a review on it. I'll mention.
I did the same thing.
Did you?
Yeah. I did to Oculus. I said, we want to open it. We want to. And they said no.
Did it work?
No.
Well, they said no to me. They said no to me as well.
They said no?
I was like, oh,
sorry.
Yeah. They said no.
You'll get it when you get it.
Exactly. I was very sad.
I should have said, I know Georgia Dow. Maybe that would have helped.
Oh, no, I think they would have sent it even later.
I think that's what Elon Musk is doing with my Tesla, by the way.
Oh, no, no.
Yeah, I ordered a Tesla X, you know, the one with the,
and the doors.
And yeah. I think the doors actually do kind of like that. They don't close. But
Don't say that. It's going to be another week.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I love you, Elon. I love you.
Yes.
God, you landed the spacecraft straight up and down.
So awesome, Falcon 9.
He said, you know, they posted a post saying, we're sorry about the Model X. I think it was, they called it hubris. They tried to do too much with the Model X technology. And anyway, I got a VIN number like 800, like a really low one, right? But
wow.
One would think they've made 800 by now. He says they have. Not mine, apparently.
Have you told them that you'll talk about it on the show?
No, I think they don't want me to talk about it on the show. I think, honestly, there's a little tag on my file that says, don't tell Leo anything because he'll just blurt it out on his podcast. I swear, because nothing. I'll get it when I get
any
it.
Any advertising is good advertising.
I'll get it when I get it, and I'll be happy. Greg Farrow is our newest victim, and you are great, Greg. You come back soon, okay?
I can't wait, Leo. It's been a fantastic opportunity, and I've really enjoyed myself.
How long is packet pushers typically?
It varies anywhere from 30 to minutes to 2 hours.
Oh, good. Okay, good. All right.
Because we're covering technology, we talk about it until it's dead.
Yeah, that's pretty much this show. Yeah.
Yeah,
and it's dead now. Yeah. It killed
sometimes it. There's only a little bit to talk about, and sometimes you can just keep waffling on for hours and hours and hours. We do put out multiple shows a week, so we do put out 5 shows a week.
Oh, you're a punter. I do twice that.
There's twice that in one day.
In one day! Everybody go to pixelpushers.net to hear more of Greg.
Yeah. Our problem, of course,
packet
is
pushers.
That we just don't have enough advertisers. That's why otherwise we'd have more content.
We're going to get you more advertisers. I think you're talking to Lisa about that, right?
We are. Yeah,
good.
We're working together. We're delivering something today.
Good. See, we're going to work this out. Thank you all for being here. Thanks to our live studio audience. You've been very patient. Not one of them went to the bathroom the whole time. It's amazing. You can be in the live studio audience. And by the way, bathroom breaks are allowed. If you just email tickets@twit.tv, we'll make sure we get a chair set out for you. There's even a young lady in the audience who's been very patient. Good job. Nice job. She's a budding geek. And I say that with love in my heart. If you want to watch live, you can do it every Saturday. I'm sorry, Sunday afternoon, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time, 2200 UTC. But you can also get on-demand audio and video of every show we do at twit.tv. In this case, I don't even know what the URL. Just go to twit.tv and click the shows button. You can also get it on YouTube. We've got apps on every platform, including Apple TV. There's 5 apps on Apple TV. Roku, iOS, Android, Windows Phone, and more. Or use your podcast app and subscribe. You do want to subscribe. You don't want to miss an episode. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time. Another twit this is in the can. Bye-bye.
Yay. Yay.